What if Naruto was the master of summons final part? Naruto the Master of Summons by Mad Raptor Fanfiction. Disclaimer. Naruto, High School DxD, Fate, Series Story Start. Chapter 8, UMU. Nero was both shocked and excited that her enemy was so proficient in war, to take out the best of what was Russia had to offer by offering himself as bait. She was happy that she was going to have a worthy and worthwhile challenge of this rebellion, but she couldn't help but feel like her opponent was overlooking the fact that her name carried weight to it. Apparently, Naruto Uzumaki was now fully aware that her name was Nero and that she was leading the rebellion against him. Standing in front of her was an 8-year-old child. The child was equipped with a large metal backpack and two thick metal boots, and thick metal gauntlets over his hands. He had blonde hair and blue eyes and peach skin, but his face was completely emotionless. The front of his chest had a glowing red gem that was situated and attached to the rest of the machinery on his body. He was staffed with a prototype of a war machine. "This is my Type 1 mage armor, and so long as you will protect me I will provide you with more Type 1 mage armors and the designer babies to wield them," Orochimaru stated as he made a deal with Nero. Finding her base was somewhat easy for him, because the second he heard of a rebel base that seemed to be holding their own, he pinpointed the only spot on the world where a rebel base had not been announced to have been destroyed. Orochimaru was spying on Naruto's communications, so the fact that Naruto knew that Nero's base was in Rome but he wasn't doing anything about it showed that he was waiting for Nero to make a more direct move against him. Since Ilya had escaped his lab, and the Yakuza had put a bounty on his head, he had been forced to leave Japan for the safety of other countries where he could hopefully use one of his hidden labs to create more designer babies and the equipment to take down the biggest threat to himself. "This is amazing. But this is strapped to a child. And what is a designer baby?" Nero asked in confusion. "This is a homunculus created using some of the king's own DNA, though they are vastly inferior to him. I already have 11 of them produced and ready for combat. If they are killed in battle, they will explode with enough force to level a city block with ease. I offer them to your service so long as I am protected." Orochimaru bowed his head to Nero. He would offer all of his services to her so long as any threats to himself were eliminated.
The fact Naruto wasn't after his life meant that Ilya was still looking for Naruto, which gave him time to use all of his genius to develop weapons of mass destruction to use against them. He had already memorized the European mage's magical formulas so that he could incorporate them into his inventions.
"And you?" Nero asked as she looked at the most suspicious figure. "Azazel. My sources state that Naruto is secretly having the world's nukes moved to a hidden location, and when I tried to use my usual methods to see what he was doing, I was blocked. Naruto plans to target the underworld and heaven eventually now that he had conquered the human realm. Azazel needed to talk with the rebel leader. The best bet would be to take sides with Naruto on this, but the fact would remain that he was no longer in a position where he could be on Naruto's side and retain any power over the teen. He wasn't against Naruto, but he was not going to help Naruto either. He would have Grigori take no actions against Naruto at the most. Not that many would fight Naruto. After it became known to other fallen angels that one of their leaders, Kokabeel, was murdered by Uzumaki Naruto using cheese as his weapon, he had become something of a boogeyman. His actions had instilled a fear into the moderate and weak fallen angels, to the point that if they came face to face with Naruto they would have no chance of being able to muster the will to fight. No action wasted. Naruto did horrible things to supernatural species that he knew would become confirmed rumors, and thus create a natural fear of his very existence. Even while he was on a path to take over the world, he was already laying his plans to rip away the morale of the fallen angels who would try to put up a fight against him. The world was playing checkers. Naruto was playing chess. In Kuo, you actually did it. You took over the entire world." Nobody knew what to say to Naruto when he returned to the clubroom for the first time in days. Nobody was in the dark about what had been happening all over the world. Naruto had the takeover of the planet on television, and he had proclaimed himself the king of Earth. Nobody could ever deny the fact that when Naruto now called himself the king of the world, that he wasn't being cocky or talking out of his ass. His words were now undeniable fact, to the point that it was terrifying to think. "Of course, that's my Naruto for you," Ravel just bragged. She was still sweating nervously though. Asia was silent, since she was still unsure of how to take all of the death. As understanding as she was of the fact that the deaths had been kept to the lowest possible number, and Naruto made sure the dead were all treated with respect, a lot of people were dying. Naruto had ordered the deaths of countless people, and looking into his eyes she could see how much their deaths weighed on him. She could see how much it hurt him. This entire time, you were 100% serious. Meaning you plan to eventually take over the underworld eventually too? Rias asked Naruto as he sat down. She had been released from jail after her ID card and visa had been issued to her, proving that she was a transfer student from the underworld and proclaiming her status as a devil. There was almost no reason for the occult research club to exist anymore now that her being a devil wasn't a secret. Everyone but those who used to be humans needed visas, but all devils needed ID cards to show they weren't human. Naruto revealed the supernatural to the world of humans. Naruto made eye contact with Asia. Of course he does, my lord is perfection incarnate. I will serve faithfully as his knight for all of time, until the day he tells me that he needs my death. Zenovia gave a salute to Naruto with a proud smile. His actions just proved his words to her. Taking over the world was not the actions of a mere man, they were the actions of one who stood above man. The fact that he planned on taking over the world before he ever had his servants was something that meant he had been planning this for a long time. His servants only allowed him to push his plans into action much faster. Naruto glanced at Akeno as she glared at him. You have something to say to me? Naruto asked her without a care. You managed all of this, and you still aren't satisfied. You're a half-breed like me, and you were hated by others for being. Naruto put his hand on Zenovia's shoulder when she pulled her Durandal out and took a swing at Akeno for her words against him. Naruto made eye contact with Zenovia, and she put her sword away and nodded her head. She moved back so that she was standing behind Asia, her job for the most part. Zenovia's number one order: protect Asia Argento at all costs, even at the cost of her life if need be. Jealousy won't get you anywhere, so either drop your stupid hatred of me, or do me a favor and die now like the filthy fallen angel you are. Naruto. That is cruel and uncalled foe, Rias started, before she flinched when Naruto stood up and stared down the shocked and hurt Akeno as she stepped back. Every person in the room was stone cold silent when Naruto glared at Akeno. Akeno had tears in her eyes and she turned to run out of the room. You will stay right there while I talk to you. Akeno was frozen in place. I took over the entire world and united them under my banner. I will not be insulted for my dream, when you never had a dream. A pathetic girl who has never had anything worth chasing after will not lecture me. You hate me because you wish you were like me. I have a dream, and I chase my dream with everything I have. You don't have a dream, you just want to spend your life being submissive to Rias because she made you feel loved and special. You're complacent, and perfectly okay with not moving forward in life. Naruto spoke very harshly to Akeno. It was time for her to learn her place. I have a dream. You lie. You don't have a dream, you chase your desires, but that is not a goal. There is a difference between having a dream you work towards and following your immediate desires. You know this, and you know full well why you hate me. So here is your own chance: try and kill me now, or bite your tongue and never look at me with those eyes again. If you truly hate me, you will manage to attack me. If you hate the fact you're not me, you won't be able to land so much as a blow on me. Naruto stated to her as he raised his arms out. The room was silent as tears streamed down Akeno's face. Naruto was harsher than usual. Everyone knew Akeno hated Naruto, but Naruto always seemed to ignore Akeno's hatred before now. This was the first time they ever saw him react to her anger and hate with any negativity. Revel, on the other hand, was a little hot under the collar. Dude. That is harsh. Kaneko had to say when Akeno turned and ran out of the room at full speed. Akeno. Rias shouted as she ran after Akeno. She actually glared at Naruto as she passed by him, because he made her queen cry, but she quickly vanished. Naruto sat back down and crossed his arms. Asia put her hand on Naruto's arm. You didn't have to be so mean to her. Yes, I did. I don't like her, and she doesn't like me. The more of my dream I attain, the more she will hate me. Eventually, I will kill her if she ever makes a move against me. If I kill Akeno, I will have to kill Rias when she attacks me. I plan to conquer the underworld as well eventually, so until my prep work for the underworld is done, I won't take any risks I can't afford. Naruto stated with his arms crossed even tighter. Akeno was a liability to him, and he held no affection for her, so if she attacked him, he would actually behead her then and there to prove a point. Until his secret agent in the underworld finished the task that Naruto had given him, Naruto was at a disadvantage if he were to declare war on the underworld. He needed to first undermine the rule of the Satans, meaning that one or two of the Satans would have to die. He needed to carefully select that Satan that he would be able to challenge to a fight, that he could kill with 100% certainty. A way that he could 100% assure that the Satan would be dead and he would be able to take their title from them. Thanks to his status as high class now, he could challenge the Satans to a duel for their title, but he needed to select the time, place and conditions very carefully. He still needed to wipe out the rebels on Earth before he made moves against the underworld. "Master, Master! Your loyal archer is here to give you a present," Oda shouted as she came through the door with a large sack that was leaking blood from it. She had the widest and most confident grin on his face. Naruto was confused. "I did not summon you. How long have you been summoned?" Naruto asked her, since he had no memory of calling her out of his soul. She just smiled. "I summoned myself, because I wanted to surprise you. You managed to take over the world, and that deserves a present from your best. And I repeat, your best servant." Oda made absolutely sure that everyone heard that part. She opened the sack and she started to throw severed heads on the table. Zeus, Hera, Poseidon, Demeter, Athena, Apollo, Artemis, Ares, Aphrodite, Hephaestus, Hermes, Hestia, and Dionysus were all lined up quickly on the table in the middle of the room. Asia quickly covered her mouth and let out a short scream of horror at the burned up severed heads. "Oda, you just made things far more challenging for me." Naruto palmed his face. Now that the Greek gods were destroyed, there was going to be a massive power vacuum that would need to be filled, and the other pantheons were going to be on alert for the ones who destroyed the Greeks. This was going to make it nearly impossible for him to get his proper prep work done, meaning he would need to build up the forces the old-fashioned way and declare war on them when the time came. "But I did do good though, right?" Naruto reached out and pat the top of her head. "Yeah, you did great. I like a challenge, good archer." Naruto rubbed the top of her head, and she beamed. No use crying over spilled Olympian blood, as the saying went. Changes. To those aware of the way magic in the world worked, a large change was happening in nature. It had started over 15 years prior to the day that the changes started to drastically grow in leaps and bounds. A small change in the breeze that started to get thicker. The world's energy started to become thicker, darker, denser, but also lighter, brighter, and yet loving as well. The entire world's balance was being thrown out of order, and it was something only the magically gifted in Senjutsu were able to tell right off the bat. The location. The fertile valleys between the Tigris and Euphrates rivers, where many of the changes had become so much greater in retrospect that the land was starting to become magically unrecognizable. Kuroka. You said the next one is going to appear here? A one-armed teenage boy with striking silver hair spoke, a fresh scar going over one of his shoulders. Bright eyes that were dimmed by his slightly injured body, and the fact that the woman he was talking to was changing the bandages wrapped around his stump of a left arm. The woman, Kuroka, a black-haired cat girl with yellow eyes, just nodded her head seriously. They have been appearing more often near this area, great beasts from before the age of man Nya. Are you sure you want to fight? Me, Astolfo, and Arthur can handle this one, just the two of us. Kuroka asked the apparent leader of their group. A pink-haired girl-looking boy saluted. That's right, Master, Temp, as long as our contract remains, you can count on me. Though I'm not all that strong. Astolfo stated as he realized his own lack of strength and scratched his own cheek. His magical energy given to him by Kushina before her death had nearly ran out, before he had been found by Kuroka and set up a temporary contact with her. As long as she could supply him with her magical energy, he would help her in whatever her goals were, so long as he wasn't opposed to them. He couldn't go along with evil people, but she seemed pretty nice. He wondered if Naruto had awakened his sacred gear and learned of his summons yet, because if so, he would need to go and find out where Naruto was. The sooner the better, but he didn't even know where he would go to find Naruto anyway. Meh. Things would work out in the end. Astolfo can't handle these creatures with you too, so you need me. Anyway, the last one took my arm. These things are extremely powerful creatures, and I won't miss out on fighting them. Valley. You're just chasing your death at this point. Kuroka shrugged her shoulders, but she did give a concerned look for Valley. For over 2 weeks they had been doing nothing but using her senjutsu to track areas where ancient monsters were starting to awaken from the dead. Kuroka was terrified. Kuroka wanted to go to Japan. every time she used senjutsu, and hunt down Naruto Uzumaki. The world kept filling her with the desire and need to have his blood on her hands. Since the moment she started to use senjutsu on Earth, it had screamed at her over and over. She was strong enough mentally, and experienced enough, to kind of ignore the cravings for blood and murder. The voices were getting louder with each new monster that came back from the dead. A young, tall man with glasses and a black suit appeared out of a portal with a golden sword, two golden swords at his side. Has it surfaces yet? Not yet, Arthur. How is the dumb monkey and your sister? Vali asked as he looked at the swordsman. Arthur Pendragon. Not well, the poison that took your arm got on them. Thankfully, since they aren't devils, it was less effective, so I didn't need to cut their arm and leg off. Arthur stated with a frown. In the last battle, they fought against a small portion of a beast that used a divine poison. It had gotten on Vali and took him out of the fight rather early, since none of them realized that it could use divine powers or poisons. Vali paid for his mistake with his arm, and now he wanted revenge now that a stronger and more complete version of the beast was going to be awakening. Less than 2 days later from the first time they defeated its previous spawn. Do you know what it was? Were you able to figure it out? Astolfo asked, since he had been ordered to get the wounded to safety as the others finished the beast off. The creature that had appeared last time had been something from before the age of man, meaning that even he had never fought one like it before. Gotta admit, I've seen a ton of stuff before, and that was not one of the things I've seen. Astolfo looked at Arthur awkwardly. The descendant of Artoria Pendragon. Or rather, this was the descendant of the bastard child of Artoria Pendragon. Since Artoria never had children other than Mordred when she had been alive, this boy was the descendant of one of Mordred's two sons. Yet, he wielded both Caliburn and Excalibur ruler quite well. He had to steal both of the swords from his family once the enemies that started to appear got more and more dangerous, but he wielded them well. My sister has a theory, but she is unconscious right now. We fought a shadow version of it, but if this is the real one, then we are in for a rough fight. I will need to see it in its complete form before I can tell if she was right or not. Arthur was polite. Out of all of them, he had been the least injured in all of the battles. He was one of the supernatural world's best swordsmen for a reason, with only a handful of people surpassing his skill. He was the weakest of the group physically if you didn't count his mage sister, but he was the most agile and hard to land a hit on as well. They are spawning faster, and the thicker the power grows in these places, the stronger they get when they respawn. Gah. I really wish Saber or Berserker were here. This kind of battle is right up their alley. Or even Lancer. She could make the thing die by singing at it. Astolfo could remember, very happily, the times he spent with the other servants under Kashina. When he requested his freedom from her to travel the world for a set amount of time, before returning to her, he never imagined she would die during that time. All he knew was that one of them had knocked her up, which none of them knew was possible. They thought that their spirit bodies just shot blanks, and they did shoot blanks. None of them could get a woman pregnant. Not Saber though. Her dick had been given to her by Merlin's magic, and the magic had the properties to grow a penis that could impregnate and birth a son. It was the literal spell used for the females of the peerage to give Kashina what she needed for her insatiable appetite. The males of the peerage had not been enough to satisfy Kashina, at all. No matter how much they tried, they alone were not enough to keep her libido in check during her teenage years. She calmed way down when she became an adult, but without Merlin giving Saber and the other girls dicks, there would have been no way for any of them to have satisfied the woman. Astolfo, pay attention. Kuroka ordered. Right, master, temp. Astolfo saluted Kuroka with a smile. Thanks to his little bit of madness and insanity, he often got lost in his own thoughts. Arthur stabbed his sword into the ground, and he put his ear up against the handle. Seems it sensed Astolfo. Arthur stated as he glanced towards their resident beast magnet. It seemed that the creatures that were coming back from the dead were attracted to similar things to themselves. Astolfo was an old paladin come back from the dead, and gave off a very unique magical signature. Creatures being revived naturally wanted to target him and those around him, as if unable to quench their desire for combat against heroes. Hehehe. This. Too bad Caster isn't here, or he could tell us the weaknesses of what we are fighting. He always had knowledge on like everything. Then again, he would totally give Master, Temp, a dick to fuck me with or something. Guy was always kind of a perv like that. Astolfo stated as he rubbed the back of his head awkwardly. He could see Merlin doing that just to mess with him, or to amuse himself. Merlin was the legendary dick wizard after all. Though, to be fair, his dick magic was based on the dick ruin magic that had been developed by Skathach. That sounds convenient. If I had that magic, I could get a whole bunch of strong girls pregnant with my children. Does this magic actually exist? Kuroko was very curious about that. Transformation magic existed, and was practiced to some degree by everybody that wanted to stay looking young. Even Sears X Lucifer was known for taking the form of a black cat now and again, something she found very annoying. Still, if a woman grew a dick with transformation magic, it was a worthless dick that could not impregnate other women. Magic that could grow a dick that could do something like that was more than impressive. Oh yes, Skathach had her dick ruins, Merlin had his dick spell, and I know the Egyptian curses could do stuff like that too. Oh, and there is this magic on the moon that can make people go insane and give them big penises. Or shrinks them. I've suffered from both of those. Oh, and the Uzumaki created a mask that can enslave gods, and they made this. Ancient magic is kind of perverted, isn't it? Arthur asked with an awkward blush as the ground started to rumble. This conversation was helping to lighten the mood. Have you ever met an old god? They are all perverts when it comes to one thing or another. I found a lot of the old god's sex stuff on the moon before. Not to mention when I chased some harpies and sealed them in hell, where I found some disturbing stuff there too. It's always the perverts who seem to gain power in history. Astolfo saw the ground crack. He jumped into the air and whistled, with a hippogriff coming out of nowhere so that he could join the battle. He took to the sky as the monster erupted from the ground. A massive green, sickly green, serpent creature with two arms. Yep, that looks like Bashmu from what my sister described of it. This is the complete spawn, so don't let any of its poison touch you. Arthur drew his sword and prepped himself for battle. Vali summoned dragon wings that had glowing blue parts. Kuroka jumped back and prepared to play a support role. This was going to be a hard battle. So, you're just okay with all of this?
Asia whispered across the dinner table to Ravel, since Naruto had not been home for a little bit while he had been out conquering the entire world. Not that he did just that, you would think he would have some more free time to spend time with her. That was apparently not the case, since he was looking over a map of the countries of the world with a red Sharpie in his hand.
Of course I am. My future husband conquered the world. Devil, fallen angel, yokai, he could still be a human for all that mattered at this point, and my parents would approve of him. Ravel didn't feel the need to whisper. She was impressed more than anyone that her thoughts on his grit and determination to complete his dreams had led to him actually using the tools at his disposal to conquer the world. Naruto snapped his fingers and drew a red circle around Rome. Got it. The enemy is Nero Claudius Caesar Augustus Germanicus, the fifth Roman emperor. Interesting, and this makes things far more. Naruto trailed off as he circled the base of operations where his enemy was. One of Rome's most famous locations, where Nero would get an amazing boost in power and be able to maintain her form. It was one of the few appropriate and easy to protect places that would be left untouched by his conquering of the world. As one of the great Struthers of the world, he wouldn't have put too much damage on it. Who? Asia asked as she tilted her head. Rome's fifth emperor, who was hated by the rich and beloved by the poor. She had a populist style of rule, and put heavy taxes on the rich to pay for the things she wanted to happen with her country. The lower class loved her, and she was a tyrant who put all her enemies to death if she discovered them. She. Nero was male. No, she is female. Once I had a name, I had Castor searching the underworld spirits for her soul, but it wasn't there. Considering she was the first Roman emperor to bring shame to the title by killing herself after being tried in absentia, there were some Roman spirits willing to sell her out to Castor. Naruto stated as he started to write down his plans. A grin started to work its way over his face. So, you're leaving to go attack. When you just got back? Asia asked, with a sad face. Loss of life happened in war, and she knew better than anyone that Naruto took each life that was lost seriously. He wasn't evil at heart, and he did everything in his power to limit the scope of lives lost to the least possible number he could manage. She herself had taken a minor part in the slaying of a couple of devils in the past, so her hands weren't 100% free of blood either. Naruto just got back to her, and it made her sad. Of course I'm not leaving now. I can kill Nero at absolutely any time right now that I've discovered her weakness. Naruto stated with a grin. Ravel seemed interested. Oh. Servants are bound by their cause of death and their history in a way. As it stands, right now I can hold a trial with Nero not there, and the very fact I'm putting her on trial will force her to follow fate and kill herself. Unlike Jack, who is a legend based in mystery, everything is known about Nero. But this is the perfect chance for me. So, I'm going to leave Nero alone for a while. Naruto stated with a grin. He started to load his plate with the food that Asia prepared for him. That doesn't seem like you. You can kill your enemy right now, but you aren't doing it. Ravel narrowed her eyes and prepared to fight. This man might not be Naruto. Naruto pointed his fork at her. Of course, I'm going to let Nero gather all the rebels under one banner. I'll let her give hope to all those who don't believe in the freedom and peace I will grant them, hope that they can defeat me. Nero is beloved by the poor and low class for a reason, she will serve as their light of hope. Naruto stated with his grin growing more and more challenging. Anyway, with the Greek deities dead, there is a vacancy on Mount Olympus that other gods will target. Rome worships the Greek gods, you can say, and there is a good chance that Nero's followers will stop believing in their gods the longer they realize she is a dead woman who came back to life. Naruto stated with a grin. Nero's existence would help him weaken the gods of the other factions, and the longer he left her alone, the greater the chance that the other gods would weaken more. Just the fact he revealed devils to the world dropped the power of Greek gods and no doubt other gods by 30%. It raised the power of devils, angels, and fallen angels by about the same amount at the same time, since now more people believed in them. Gather all the rebels? Ravel repeated Naruto's words. I'm lost. Asia didn't understand this strategy stuff. The more I have my servants out there crushing rebel bases, the higher the chance innocents get involved. I'll let Nero gather herself an army of rebels, give them hope for victory, and then crush about 70% of their army and take away that hope they can win. I'll use myself as bait. Asia understood that. No. You can't use yourself as bait, that is too dangerous. Your body can't handle much more of this. Asia stated loudly, much to Ravel's surprise. Since from what she could see, Naruto seemed perfectly healthy to her. Asia moved her eyes to Naruto's right hand, which had only a slight shiver to it. Eh. Ravel stated lowly. She didn't get it. Ever since Naruto got back, he's been hiding how hurt he is. He can't even move his pinky or ring fingers on his right hand, and the skin on his left arm is paler. Asia was going to bring all of this up to Naruto in private, but she couldn't stay silent if he planned on putting himself in danger. The way he held his fork showed that he couldn't move two of his fingers, he wasn't standing up as well as he normally did, his balance was off, and she could see just how much pain he was in. Naruto smiled for a second. Asia, I'm fine, Asia slapped him. Don't lie to me. I can't tell when you're lying or you're hurt. Asia started to nurse her sore hand. She had not hurt Naruto with that slap at all, but even without it hurting him, he still held his cheek in surprise. She was concerned for him. It's true, right now I've been reduced to around a third of how strong I normally am. Maybe even less than that actually. Using my servants all out like this has been causing a lot of stress on my body. And using them for several days straight without rest, at their full powers like this. Still, it doesn't matter how much pain I'm in, or how much I suffer. This pain is just par for the course when it comes to my goals. Naruto stood up from his chair. He took off his jacket and put it down on the table. Half of his body was deathly pale. He had no visible wounds, but the flesh nearly half of his torso was deathly pale in spots. The massive amount of stress that his strongest servants going full power for days straight had taken such a strong toll on his body that he could collapse at any moment. He was between a fifth and a third of his full power if he had to honestly judge himself at the moment. So. That is why you switched to caster and assassin, and put saber and lancer away. Your body isn't able to handle using them at the moment. So you switched to your easiest to manage servants. You've conquered the world. Ravel mumbled as she started to understand what Asia had noticed. Something that she and everyone else would have never seen if Naruto didn't take his jacket off. Asia rushed to Naruto and started to try to heal him. You can't heal this. The wounds on my body are spiritual, not physical. I put too much stress on my spirit, and until my spirit is healed, my body won't recover. Naruto stated to Asia as she put her head up against his chest. She couldn't even heal him. So, you're giving yourself time to heal before crushing Nero's army. Ravel guessed, trying to think if she knew any way to heal a wounded spirit. She couldn't think of anything. No, I'm giving Nero 30 days to gather as much an army as she can. I'm going to have Castor put pressure on where certain areas that will limit the scope of where she can take control. I will let her build her army, but she will do so on my terms. I won't allow her to get help from the other gods either. Naruto stated, sure of himself. He was sure that his body would last another 30 days for sure without resting his spirit. The stress he was putting on it was nothing compared to the suffering he had inflicted on others. It didn't matter if it felt like every cell in his body felt like it had cold fire injected into it, or how the very act of breathing made him feel like he was sucking pure hellfire into his lungs. The fact his very existence was nothing but pain and suffering right now, and the parts of his body he couldn't feel at all wasn't much comfort to him, was just the price he was going to have to pay. People lost their loved ones because of him, so this was the pain he would bear until he could show the people who felt lost that the world he would create for them would be a free world of beauty. 30 days. You can't hold out that long. I don't have a choice, I will hold out that long. When you crush people's hope, they see things in a new light. I will crush hope that they can beat me, so that they can see the light of my ideals. I need to crush them to release them from the chains that bind them. One day, all of the people of this world will be free to chase their dreams, invent wonderful things, and see that in my eyes, they are all equal. Before that can happen, I need to show them my power. Naruto had no choice but to put himself through this suffering. His dreams. The dreams of all of humanity, he alone needed to bear all of the pain and show the world a path to a new, brighter light. Anyway, since summer break is starting, I can use those 30 days in the underworld to further my goals there as well. For that, I'll need your help, Ravel. My Bishop Ravel. Naruto offered her his hand. He was a high-class devil now. He qualified for his own peerage, and he was offering Ravel the chance to be traded to him. Ravel didn't even hesitate to grab his hand. You have my full support, because when you go too far, I'll be there to hold you back and remind you how stupid you are. Ravel let go of his hand and crossed her arms under her bust. Oh. Senjutsu can be used to heal your spirit, or at least reduce how much damage you are taking. Ravel just remembered that. I don't know Senjutsu, and I don't know anyone who can use it. I'll just put up with the suffering for 30 days. Anyway, as it stands, 99% of the devil population is forbidden from coming to the human realm without first undergoing the visa process. I need to go to the underworld to see how quickly the devil species will lose power over that. Naruto stated as he thought on that. As it stood, he was only allowing devils that he believed he could turn to his side to be welcome on Earth. All others that he didn't believe would be turned would be denied. So while the devil species got a temporary 30% boost to their power, soon enough that boost would be gone and they would start to lose power. He needed to see how much power would be lost over a 30-day period, so he could prepare for when the perfect time to launch his assault would be. You have the full backing of the Fenix, my parents and brothers are on your side. I already explained that you conquered Earth, and you would target the underworld eventually. So long as you grant them a high standing in society, they will offer you their support in Phoenix Tears. Ravel bragged about her family turning into traitors against their own race. They picked the winning side was all. The boy who became a high-class devil within 2 months of being a devil, and conquered the entire world before his 16th birthday, as well as defeating the strongest young devil in single combat, while also having access to Excalibur and a servant will holy powers. Naruto was perfectly prepared to take down the underworld, and her family would always side with the people they believed to be the ultimate winners. Is there anything I can do? To support you? I can't even heal you when you're hurt right now. Asia asked as she showed the tears in her eyes. Naruto frowned. Just be by my side, that's all I want from you. As long as you're with me, no matter how much pain I have to endure, I will endure it. Naruto forced a grin on his face and rubbed the top of her head. Naruto's hand was still big and warm on her head. That alone made Asia smile. Ravel felt uncomfortable. Jack the Ripper made Ravel Fenix feel very uncomfortable, considering the fact this was the number one servant out of all of Naruto's servants that seemed to just be willing to commit mass genocide if Naruto ordered it. She had an unnatural way of thinking, an unnatural way of existing, and her abilities were frightening. Ravel didn't remember Jack's abilities anymore. That was what was more terrifying, the fact that Ravel was terrified of her abilities even though she didn't remember them. Jack seemed to have the ability to erase all information about herself and her abilities from people's minds. She was Naruto's number one, because her abilities alone are what allowed him to take over several countries. Ravel was a devil. Jack the Ripper was the epitome of chaotic evil itself. I thought this would have been a train ride for just us, this is the Fenix private trainer after all. Ravel stated, Since Akainu was experiencing a severe depression, Naruto decided not to ride with the Gremory peerage on the 30-day trip to the underworld. She had been happy to have some more alone time with him. Naruto spent 90% of his time when he wasn't ruling the world, with Asia making her feel better about the pain he was in. "I need to give Jack her orders," Naruto stated to Ravel. "I already have my agent in the underworld furthering my goals here, but Jack is important. Actually, but if Jack can do her job properly in the next 30 days, in 32 days I will have the entire underworld under my control," Naruto stated as he smiled at Jack and pat the top of her head. A secret ability that she had. Assassinating the Devil Kings won't. Only one Devil King needs to die, and I've already picked who the best one would be. Say, Ravel. How many devils would you say exist? Considering your long lifespan and how low the birthrate is, I wouldn't expect there to be a lot. Most modern devils would be half-bloods and low class. Naruto stated with a grin. Ravel did some mental math. "Well, honestly, our population is usually stagnant around 15,000 devils overall." Ravel was curious about this. Once upon a time, she would have thought Naruto insane for saying he could create a situation where he could take over the entire devil race in 32 days. Now, after knowing him and seeing him take over Earth for himself, she knew not to doubt his claims. This was the king of Earth after all. "Jack, how many wraith souls make up your body?" Naruto asked Jack with a growing smile on his face. That was a number that was well within his ideals for a great situation for him. Jack was confused for a second, before she remembered what one of her own abilities was. Possession. She had the ability to push one of the souls inside of her body into children and young teens, and possess them to hold them hostage or force them to do her bidding. She had over tens of thousands of souls inside of her body that would allow her to take over all of the children in the entire underworld, and even a good number of the young teens as well. The supernatural were a lot stronger than humans, so they couldn't be simply intimidated by a simple display of raw power. "Enough. Good, make it happen," Naruto stated to her as he opened the window of the train. Jack bowed to him as a wicked smile came over her lips. It was sweet and cute, but the malice behind her smile was far too easy to see for anyone. Ravel was confused, even more so. "I do want to point out that my family has agreed to turn traitor for your cause, so you have our support. And whatever that monster is going to do, you don't have to do to us." Ravel nervously spoke. She would hate to be on the receiving end of that monster a second time. She didn't need to know what Naruto was going to have her to do, know that it was going to be horrifying. Naruto just smiled. "With humanity, I needed a show of ultimate power to make them submit. More than 99% of humanity has submit to my rule, with less than 1% rebelling. With devils, I need to show them I'm far more evil than them, that if they ever decide to try and fight me, they will regret it to their very core." Naruto started off with a smile. Ravel nodded her head. She was a traitor to her race, but this was her desire. She was chasing the ultimate man, a man who didn't dream small. Her dream was to be his woman, and become help him reach his dream. The greater he became, the greater she became known as. "You're not evil though." "I'm not, but I need them to think I am. That is why Jack is going to possess and hold hostage all children in the underworld. With my agent having given me a list of the homes of all children, and with Jack having 30 days to do her job, it can be done," Naruto stated as he showed the chessboard between himself and Ravel. They weren't playing chess per se. Naruto took all of the pawns off of the board and moved them to his side of the board, so that Ravel didn't have any pawns to play with. Ravel watched him do that, and she furrowed her brow. Ravel reached out and she realized that Naruto was adding a good portion of the population to his own forces. "You can threaten to wipe out an entire generation of devils, or force parents to have to kill their children, or surrender as to not have to do that. Those who are possessed by Jack, controlled by her, can be forced to use her abilities. With thousands of Jack the Rippers moving around, I can blanket most of the underworld in her mist. Then, using my army of Jack the Rippers, I can easily wipe out all women in the underworld, and I will make that known beforehand. And will prove my point by eliminating 250 in 1 hour," Naruto stated as he took both of the rooks off of Ravel's side of the field and tossed them to the ground. "How many women will fight in a war where the second they join the war, they die for it?" Naruto asked Ravel with a smirk. She put her hand to her mouth in thought. "So, no children and teens. And no women. With that alone, you're eliminating nearly 75% of all devils as potential enemies. I have no doubt the fact, Revel gasped when she realized just how massive of an advantage that Jack was going to be to Naruto's absolute dominance over the underworld. Low and middle class devils won't be able to fight back at all, because nearly all of low and middle class devils used to be other species. They have far more human feelings and morals. Not to mention, they don't have any reason to fight against an enemy that can end them instantly. Revel stated with a shocked gaze. Naruto took both of the bishops off of Revel's side of the field and added them to his own side, as well as the rooks.
Many low and middle class devils hated the upper class to some degree, and if worse came to worse, they wouldn't risk themselves to fight a battle to save the upper classes. Combine that with the fear of not being able to avoid assassination, and being forced to give up or else be forced to fight their own children. The king, the devil kings, the queen, the good-hearted, and the knight, the 72 pillar families and their peerages. By killing only one of the devil kings and taking their throne for myself, I can demoralize even more devils further. My enemy will not be the entire devil race, my enemy will be only those evil enough to not care about what happens to the devil race. Naruto stated as he took the queen off of Revel's side of the field and added it to his own.
Revel's board had the king and the knights. Naruto had one king, two queens, four bishops, four rooks, two knights, and 16 rooks on his side of the field.
This won't be a war, this will be a slaughter, you're going to wipe out the most heartless devils. All those who oppose you will be labeled as a monster, and because they are showing they don't care about what happens to. Revel trailed off as she took one of the knights and gave it to Naruto as well. The members of the 72 pillar families, the ones who cared about the lower classes, would no doubt join Naruto in the end. Naruto wasn't making a war, he was creating a civil war where he would make himself the leader using fear. Then, once he won the war, he would release the fear he himself caused by freeing the children from Jack's control.
Want to play a game of chess with a board like this? Naruto asked as he gestured to the board.
There isn't a chess player alive that could win under these conditions, you've created an impossible to win situation. Devil kind can't even attack you directly without risking complete and utter genocide, and there are many devils who are afraid of fallen angels and angels attacking us if we weaken ourselves too much. Revel stated with a growing smile on her own face.
This was military genius. Naruto was also making sure to take the position of Devil King as well before he put those to action, so that his rule couldn't be contested easily. Then if he proved to be a great leader against the other three Devil Kings, Naruto would gain the support of most of the entire devil race out of either respect or fear. Naruto would then be able to force the other three kings to forfeit their positions to him, and thus he would become the only Devil King. Only 500 people will die if all things go well. But if they won't go well, the people who oppose me will be wiped out totally. Having thousands of Jack the Rippers assassinating my most evil of enemies won't make me lose any sleep. Naruto stated as he tapped the top of his kingpiece and he moved it across the entire board and knocked over Revel's knight and kingpiece. Devils are powerful and supernatural, but because of that, they are extremely easy to predict. I've looked at your history books, your species doesn't have the same advanced military strategy that humans have been forced to develop over the years. Naruto stated as Revel started to breath heavily. This was hot. She was so turned on right now as she looked at the absolute military victory that could be seen before her, and the pure strategy that placed an impossible situation over her own race. She hadn't felt this turned on since Naruto enslaved the entire vampire race, and she spent the entire night after that masturbating. Take me now. Just do me. Revel, my entire body is dominated by pain and suffering. Not in any condition for sex until I recover. Naruto stated to her. She nodded in understanding, she could get boned later. While Rias Gremory had her peerage training during most of the time that they were taking a break from school, Naruto didn't obey Rias' orders anymore. As if he obeyed her in the first place. 18 days. Mommy, we've got everything set, your orders are done. Jack had finished her preparations early. She put 10 of her wraiths into every child, and had those children spread out and infect more children. By doing that, she managed to drastically speed up the time it would take in order for her to gain completely control of every single person in the underworld who was younger than 15 years old. With her stealth, she got everyone from the highest of ranks to the lowest. Naruto controlled her. She controlled what was currently one quarter of the entire underworld population when it came to devils at least. It would take mere moments for her to give the orders to have the entire underworld slaughtered by her possessed child army. Naruto gave her a head pat. Good girl, Jack, good girl. You're a good girl indeed. Naruto pat her head and gave her the highest of praise for her job well done. She had finished faster than he had expected, and he had high expectations for her to start with. The first stages of his plot were done. Now spread the mist. Naruto stated to Jack, and she nodded. With her ability Murder on a Misty Night, she could create the mist wherever she wanted to create it. Her possessed children had access to her abilities, and with them covering the entire underworld, they were just focus points for her to have them activate her ability. Naruto was staying at the Fennec's castle, but from where he was standing he could see a city that belonged in the Fennec's territory. He could also see another city in the distance, and a city between those cities. All three of those cities had mist start to appear inside of them, completely surrounding the cities in a thick mist that began to spread more and more until the different mists started to connect to each order. Soon enough, there was a thick mist for as far as the eye could see. Jack could cover the entire city in mist easily. Thousands of Jacks with their powers multiplied together and enhanced could cover the entire underworld in the mist and keep the mist there for as long as Naruto wanted. The condition was set up, and Naruto had completed another step of his plan. Reiser believes this is a terrifying sight. Reiser, I thought that you were Revel for a second. What do you want? Naruto asked as he glanced back and saw Reiser staring at him. Reiser nodded to him. I wish to express that the Fennec family, all of us, will be siding with you. Mother and father have already expressed this to you. We can assume that you will not kill any of us if we side with you, correct? Including our peerages? Reiser asked with a touch of fear audible in his voice. Naruto conquered Earth in days. Naruto setting his sights on the underworld was a terrifying thought for many people, but thankfully very few people actually knew what Naruto was planning. They decided to side with the unstoppable force, rather than to try and be immovable object. Revel had explained Naruto's plan to them, and after a lot of talk, it was easily decided that they would give 100% of their backing to Naruto in the coming days. Originally they were going to support him, but only do so in secret in order to be able to claim innocence if Naruto failed. His plan was too perfect. All people who surrender to me will be safe from my wrath. Tell your parents that for the next step of my plan, I need them to host a celebration. Have it be a massive celebration, and invite the Saiyans to it. They have 4 days to get this step of my plan done. Naruto stated to Reiser, and he gave out his strict orders. What will you have us do now? Jack asked Naruto with a wide and hopeful smile. You will be needed, but Reiser, gather every bottle of Phoenix Tears. Stop selling them to other families, and buy back all bottles from the people they were sold to, and claim that they were impure. Naruto gave more orders to Reiser. But that will be a great, your family's wealth will be fine. Consider this an investment in buying your place under my rule. Weakening the enemy before they understand they are about to go to war is the key element in a surprise attack. Naruto explained his reasons, if only to sat Reiser's need to expand his family's wealth. Reiser nodded in a subdued way and left. Mommy? Jack, you will be needed is what I said. Use your surgery skill on me. For the next few days until the party, Naruto took his shirt off and tossed it to the ground. Bring my body back to full strength. It will be a temporary solution, but keep performing surgery on me until I'm in fighting condition. Naruto gave his order. Naruto reached up and caught an arrow inches from his face. How dare! How dare you! Jack shouted with true fury in her eyes. Where did that even get shot from? Naruto saw the note that was attached to the arrow. Do you know the faces of the children you killed? That was all the note said. I see. Smell this arrow, and tell me what it smells like. Naruto stated as he held the arrow out to Jack. She blinked and looked shocked for a moment, but she still ended up smelling the arrow for Naruto. Like a servant, a lion, a woman. Atalanta then, the first person to shoot the boar. Punished by the Aphrodite for not honoring her, turning her and her husband into lions. In some stories, it was Zeus that punished them. The fastest women in Greek legends, a master in archery with nearly no equal. Naruto stated with a look to his face that Jack couldn't understand. The only woman of the Argonauts, who could defeat even men in nude wrestling. A fierce foe. One who was abandoned as a child, and thus values the smiles of children more than her own life. Naruto used his historical knowledge and looked in the distance. He bit his thumb and wrote his answer. Holding the arrow, Naruto pulled his arm back. With Atalanta, that should have got him right between the eyes. Atalanta spoke as she lowered her bow. She had been summoned in the under the conditions of a place where the smiles of children would be most threatened. With the destruction of the Greek gods, her summoning had been sped up in the hopes to defend them. Sadly, she had been summoned in the underworld where she wasn't able to get to her gods in time. She could only pray that she could kill mankind's king before he set his sights further and further. She had to follow the last orders given before her summoning as well. Atalanta was a huntress given the blessings of Artemis, she would never miss a shot that she poured her heart into. Atalanta's eyes widened when her own arrow appeared in front of her face in the blink of the eye. In the time it took her to blink, literally, she had to lean back at her full speed. The arrow sailed over her head, nicking her forehead and spilling her blood. It came to a stop when it embedded itself in the building she was standing on top of. What? How? There was no way that a modern-day person can make a shot from that far away. No bows from this era should be capable of such a feat. No. These are fingerprints. Atalanta pulled her arrow out of the building. I killed 12,890,021 children, and I have all of their names memorized. I have the names of every single person who my orders have killed committed to my memory. He answered my sarcastic question. That arrow was supposed. He can't be serious. Atalanta bit into her thumb and she started to write down more onto the note. With Naruto, Naruto caught the arrow. You lie. Naruto smiled. No, as King of Earth, I will not let the sacrifice of even one of my citizens go in vain. All of those who died for the sake of my dream, I have a list of their names and memorized all of them. I have plans for them in the future. Once I've conquered the underworld, and hell, then I will be able to save all of them. With Atalanta, it wasn't a fluke, it would seem. She got her response when Naruto threw the arrow back to her. The dead don't come back, or they shouldn't come back. This world is chaos, and you are making it worse. Once I've conquered hell, all of my victims who my actions killed will have their eternal damnation ended. There will be no more hell, and I will have all of the people who died for my dreams reborn as devils and given no lives. For those who don't want that, I will have another option. Absurd, such a thing is impossible. Eternal paradise. What? I will conquer heaven, and I will grant all of the men, women, and children who died for my goals eternal joys and smiles. They will all be reunited with their families for all eternity, and I will even give them the option to become angels. I will make my dreams a reality. You are insane. I will never forget a single death I've caused, but the suffering of those who faced me will not have been for nothing. Their suffering is temporary, because I will create the perfect world and be its king. My kingdom will be a place where everyone can be free, a place where people can smile at each other. Where hatred between nations means nothing. You wish to create a world like that, truly? I don't wish to create a world like that, I will create a world like that. I didn't wish to become king of Earth, I became king because I worked towards that goal with the willpower to make it happen. If you wish for the salvation of children, you won't save them all. If you work towards that goal, then you have a better chance of succeeding. Wishes don't mean anything, only those brave enough to take action can change the world. Atalanta looked at her most recent message from Naruto, and she pondered it with a frown on her face. Her heart trembling from his words, and her own wishes to save all of the children of the world. His goal was the same as her goal, but he was going about it differently than she would have done it. He wasn't wishing for a better world like she would wish for. He is even taking the people he kills into account. He has no victims. Nobody will ever become his victim, because he plans to even give his enemies eternal peace. He's conquering hell so that he can free all of those he killed. No. He's going to bring salvation to all people who have ever died. Atalanta realized just how wide the scope of Naruto's plans were. He wasn't just saving the future or the present. He was saving all people who had ever existed. He didn't view the world as a man viewed the world. He viewed the world from a higher viewing point than even those of the gods. He saw a picture even bigger than the big picture, and made his plans using that as his reference. I've lost to him. I have no choice but to become his servant. Atalanta wrote her final message to Naruto. Archer, Atalanta, will become your servant if you will have me. The fastest huntress of Greek myth will become your bow. Use me as you see fit. Naruto gained his second archer. Nobu was not pleased with that. It was a great party. For many who were used to the Fenix family throwing large parties, it wasn't unusual for them to send out invitations with little notice. Thank whoever it is we devils can thank that I get a break from training with that sadistic dragon. Issei would pray to God for this if he could. His training had been absolutely hellish for the passing days that he had spent. 23 days of absolute hell on a training mountain with a dragon king turned devil, dragon. Now, he was getting to attend a party with Rias and the rest of her peerage at the Fenex estate with her family. I would pray to God. Thank you, Lo. Asia jolted in pain as her hands went up to her head. I will pray to Naruto, for I know all of this is his plan somehow. Zenovia was Asia's personal guard when Naruto wasn't around. She was used to Asia praying to God, and she didn't correct her. What she was doing was staying true to their faith, though Asia seemed to be unaware that she was the closest person to the person who would become God for them. Issei gave her a dull look. Naruto can't be to blame for everything. Blame. That's a bold assumption. I don't blame him, I praise him. As should you, as should everyone. Look at what he has done, he's conquered Earth and has brought the warring nations of the world to peace with each other. Now only a few rebel forces remain, and they are all after Naruto. He enslaved the entire vampire race, and forced all supernatural species across the globe to reveal themselves to humanity for fear of deportation. Now of course he has his sights on the underworld. And then heaven. Zenovia had stars in her eyes. She couldn't be happier that Naruto was keeping his promise to her at an astonishing speed. Akeno grit her teeth and sipped at the wine that a passing waiter served for her, and she looked at Rias, who was standing with her brother and talking to him rather casually. Sirzex, Ajuka, and Seraphall were all present at the party and wearing their official outfits, showing that they had received special invitations to the party. She grit her teeth even more when she saw that Azazel himself, the leader of Grigori, was attending the party. Somehow the Fenex family was allowing fallen angels to enter their castle freely. She could actually see a few fallen angels mixed together with devils. That is, no. This is one of Naruto's schemes. I can feel it. Akeno spoke with more hatred than ever before for Naruto. He forced her to eat her own hypocritical stance on him, and he had been right about everything he said. After spending days and days depressed and crying, she came to realize something.
She didn't have to like Naruto because he was right about her. She hated him more than ever because he was absolutely right about her, and now that she was forced to come face to face with just how much a failure she was, she could freely hate him purely because he was better than she was.
Naruto. What horrible things did you? Asia whispered when she looked across the room and saw that Naruto was standing at full strength. Full strength that by all means he should have no access to with the damage done to his body. It was like he had forced his body to undergo startling surgical changes purely for the sake of bringing himself back up to snuff. She knew Naruto, and she knew that this was part of his plan as well. Naruto wouldn't have forced himself to come to this party if he didn't plan to use it to further his goals. Naruto must have put his body through horrible suffering to get back to full strength. Guys, Naruto can have fun too. Not everything he does is some grande scheme to rule the world. He likes to fish, and hang out, and go to the mall for lunch. Issei was going to keep to the opinion that Naruto was just going to try and enjoy a party. Naruto walked towards them with a smile on his face. He had been listening. No, the trash bitch is absolutely right. This is one of my schemes. By the way, trash bitch, just remember, I'll murder you the second you attack me. Put that killing intent away if you want to stay alive. Naruto told Akeno when he noticed the way that she was looking at him. He was smiling in a friendly way. His smile did not reach his eyes when they looked into her eyes. Whatever. This party is one of your schemes. Who is going to die? Asia whispered as she reached out and grabbed Naruto's sleeve. She pushed his sleeve up and she looked at the new scars that were covering his arm. They went all the way up to his shoulder, and they were scars from surgery, showing that she had been right with just a glance. Naruto had Jack perform her surgery skill on him for several days in order to force his body to go back to full strength. She knew the abilities of his servants, and this was just a temporary boost to make him healthy again. Naruto was planning murder. Just a single person. Ha 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 ha. Well, if it isn't my favorite Uzumaki. Did you have fun killing my general with cheese? Azazel asked as he walked towards them and extended his hand to Naruto. Naruto grasped his hand and gripped hard enough that Azazel felt some of his bones start to crack. Strong grip. Don't worry, I'm not your enemy. I received your invitation to this party, as well as your offer. And it sounds interesting. You have the support of the fallen angel species. Azazel stated in a lower tone. There were only a handful of fallen angels who would even try their hand at fighting this monster. Not after the confirmed fact that Naruto had murdered one of the strongest of their species using his cheese murder ability. Akeno gripped her fist and accidentally shattered the wine glass. Whoa. Issei got wine all over him. Very well, glad to have your surrender. I won't have to use my plans to conquer you if you surrender peacefully. Naruto started to ignore Akeno as he smiled far more peacefully at Azazel. The man laughed. There is nothing to be gained from fighting you, and I know better than anyone just how strong that sacred gear of yours is, after all. You made it. Yes, the book had a note about you creating it. I guess in an indirect way, I should thank you. You allowed me to take over the world a lot faster than I would have otherwise. I'll have all of existence under my control in record time. Naruto stated with a more respectful tone. Azazel surrendering was a boon to him. Oh? So, you believe that? I would have still taken over the world eventually, but with this sacred gear my 20-year plan was drastically reduced. Not to mention, I now have a good reason to take over the world. A person that motivates me to try harder than before. Naruto placed his hand on Asia's shoulder and lightly squeezed it. You know, when most men say I would give you the world to a girl, they aren't being literal. Azazel looked at Asia when he said that. Naruto puffed his chest out. I do my best not to say anything I don't mean. If I say I'm going to do something, then I'm going to do it and nothing will stop me. Just like how I'm going to challenge Seraphall Leviathan to a duel for her title, right here and now. Naruto jumped up in the air and landed on top of a table, and he looked the woman in question right in her eyes as he stated that. Blue and blue eyes met for the first time, she smiled. Sorry, but you're not high enough rank to challenge me for my title. You're still just a low class. Wait, actually. You're a high class devil now, and possess nobility. Seraphall had to change what she was saying when she realized who this was. He might look like a young boy, but he was the man who currently ruled over Earth and forced them to promote him to high-ranking devil due to his political status as King of Earth. Well, that does fulfill the conditions to challenge me. Seraphall calmly ate her food as she smiled at Naruto. It was kind of funny. He just became a high class and he was challenging her for her title. She was hundreds of years older than him and far more powerful. Sure, he had the right to challenge her, but to say that he had the brains to do so was clearly not the case. People attending the party started to laugh. Keep laughing. You'll all regret it. Ravel thought as she sat next to her brothers and parents, watching over the party. Seraphall was taking this very casually. She hadn't been challenged for her title since Graphia had challenged her, and nobody ever had the guts to give her a challenge after that. After defeating the strongest queen in single combat, her strength was considered unrivaled as the strongest female devil for a good reason. She was a devil king for a reason. Still, Naruto fit the conditions to challenge her. What do you plan to give me if I win all of Earth? You will become the queen of Earth and have absolute control over humanity, and you will become the new leader of the fallen angels now that Azazel has passed his leadership onto me. Naruto stated as he gave the offer out. Instantly, all laughter in the room stopped. Wow! You even offered something of value equal to my position. Very well, with those conditions fulfilled, I'm not allowed to turn your duel away. You can name the time and place. Seraphall had no choice but to accept. He fulfilled all of the conditions needed to give her a legit challenge. The battlefield will be in the courtyard, and the time will be right now. That is fine with you, Lord Fenix? Naruto feigned a question as he looked towards the man. The man nodded with a smile. Minus 10 minutes later, there sure has been a lot of mist lately. It's covered the entire underworld. Welp, don't feel too bad when you lose, okay? I'm sure you're really powerful, but you're not on my level just yet. Seraphall stated with a very wide smile. This was going to be a fun match for her. Naruto summoned his golden sword and stabbed it into the ground in front of him. There were gasps from all people who knew what his sword was, and even Seraphall looked at the sword in shock for a moment. The first thing I will do as Devil King will be to abolish the slavery of the peerage system. Know this, all who are listening and watching on their televisions. If you wish to experience freedom once more, then once I have taken Seraphall Citri's life, follow me. Naruto crossed his arms in front of himself. It's Seraphall Leviathan. Seraphall corrected him. Naruto smiled at her peacefully. After tonight it won't be. All the conditions for my victory have been fulfilled. The first conditions is that it is night, Naruto stated as he held up a single finger. He added a second finger to the first finger, and the mist around them started to grow thicker. The audience could no longer see them. Night? Seraphall was close enough that she could still see Naruto, but his form was just barely visible to her. Thankfully, she could still sense his magical power, so that meant that she didn't need to see where he was to fight him. The second conditions is that there is mist. And the last condition. Naruto held up a second and third finger. Seraphall started to charge up her magic. She was going to finish this with one big attack that Naruto would have no chance to dodge. Seraphall raised her hands up, and Naruto grabbed Excalibur in front of him and pointed it at her. She grit her teeth when she realized the second she cast her spell, he was going to unleash an attack. She was going to have to use a very powerful attack if she was going to overpower Excalibur when wielded by a natural wielder. She could not afford to go small. The last condition? Seraphall asked to buy herself another few seconds to charge up her magic to critical levels of power. There, she was done charging. You're a woman. Wah. Seraphall hadn't even sensed another person. She turned around and prepared to launch her magical attack, but her attacker had reached point-blank range the second that she had spent turning around. She saw her attacker's grin. Maria the Ripper. With the audience, what's going on? I can't see anything. Issei asked as he narrowed his eyes and tried to watch the fight. The mist was so thick that it was practically impossible for anyone to see anything. Not to mention it was so filled with magical energy right now thanks to Seraphall charging her attack that those with sensing abilities couldn't sense what was going on either. Seraphall is going to win. In a one-on-one fight, she is practically invisible. She can even give me a run for my money in a fair fight. Sirzex spoke as a person started to make their way out of the mist. Even with his sacred gear's ability to summon familiars, that wouldn't be enough for him to overcome her easily. She's the strongest female devil after all. Sirzex had complete confidence in Seraphall. The mist started to clear up. Ravel was smirking in fear. So. This is where I will see what Naruto's assassin was going to try on me. Let's see what. Ravel's eyes widened in slight horror. People's eyes widened in shock and fear. Naruto was standing over Seraphall's corpse, and it wasn't a pretty corpse. Her funeral was going to be a close casket funeral for sure. Naruto stared down the audience with his back straight. My name is Naruto Uzumaki, the King of Earth, and now I hold the title of Leviathan. I am now one of the four devil kings who rule the underworld. Seraphall was killed in her battle against me. No. Sona Citri's screams and wails of agony echoed through the area, the girl collapsing to her knees in horror at the corpse of her sister. Sirzex stared at his friend's corpse with his eyes starting to widen in horror, and once more blue eyes made eye contact with blue eyes. He and Naruto stared each other right in the eyes, and for a second he swore that he was staring down something far more dangerous than he had initially thought. Naruto looked down at Seraphall's corpse. He took a queen piece out of his pocket and he dropped it on top of her body. Rise. Rise from your eternal slumber and become mine. Seraphall Citri, become my queen and forge your path to freedom. Naruto chanted as his queen piece started to go inside of the corpse. Her injuries started to repair themselves as her corpse was restored back to full health, and her eyes gained the life back in them. Seraphall had now experienced death and rebirth. Whoa! What the hell, I lost, and died, and why don't I remember what killed me? Seraphall screamed as she shot up. Seraphall Citri, I'm freeing you. You are my queen, but I am a man of my word. You are not like the vampires who are spoils of war who need to be educated. Go enjoy your life of freedom. But remember. Never cross me, because I can kill you at any moment I wish. Naruto told her with his face darkening.
Naruto was King of Earth. Naruto was leader of the fallen angels.
Naruto was now a devil king. The underworld was about to learn what true fear was when they realized that they had only begun to see just how much he had in store for them. She loved the underworld. It was her home, she had been born here, raised here, and one day she would have expected herself to die here. Rhea's loving family had always been there for her, her peerage was the extended family that she loved with all of her heart. She would have never thought in her life that she would have made a mistake like this.
The day that she forced Naruto to make a deal to join her peerage was the day that she doomed the underworld. She made a mistake. The underworld was a sea of flames now, with corpses everywhere. Naruto wasted no time once he had become a devil king to wage an instant war against the rest of the underworld, and he used tactics that nobody could have expected. Tactics so dark and evil that no matter how strong his enemy was, they could not stand before him.
her brother, her only brother, had been slain. Killed in his sleep by his own son, and his wife had been slain with him. Naruto's act of mercy in bringing Seraphall back to life had been just that, an act of mercy for a foe that he didn't need to kill. Every person who stood against Naruto found themselves in the worst positions imaginable. Naruto had not ordered this action. It would seem that even Naruto had been displeased with Sirzek's murder, but in the end it served his purpose.
The 72 pillar families were destroyed, the remaining ones who didn't surrender to him.
All of the children of the underworld were possessed by the spirits of Jack the Ripper, and Naruto declared as such. To attack Naruto was to mean to kill all children in the underworld, which even the most evil of devils couldn't do. The low and middle class devils didn't even try and fight. They joined Naruto when he granted them their freedom, and now all peerages were free from their masters. It took no time at all before all the wicked and cruel devils with peerages were absolutely slaughtered by their recently freed peerage members who they abused. Soon enough, the war became something impossible to win. He conquered my home. Rias could only watch her family home burning, her mother, father, and those who served the family were outside of the home. As a sign of power, Naruto ordered all high and ultimate class devils of the 72 pillars who had initially rejected him command have their homes burned to the ground as a show of dominance over them. They couldn't fight back. Her family put up no resistance to Naruto at all when they realized how hopeless it all was. 2 days. Naruto conquered the underworld in less than 2 days after being crowned Leviathan, and the other devil kings had been slaughtered for putting up resistance. Without Sirzex, the two remaining devil kings could not offer any real threat to Naruto's armies and his own threats. Naruto had 500 women killed instantly, and he gave out the threat that he could slaughter every single person in the underworld with his army of children assassins. If that wasn't enough, Naruto had nuclear warheads that were hidden all over the underworld just waiting to be used to wipe out any forces that could resist him. Jeanne d'Arc and her holy powers, and his lancer, had made quick work of Ajuka when combined with the fact that Naruto had an army of assassins of great power, the entire Fallen Angel forces, and Atalanta using long-distance arrows to bombard him from miles away. Rias had sought to use Naruto's power to end her marriage to Reiser. She had tried to manipulate him for her own gain. In doing that, she lost almost everything. It's all my fault. Earth being conquered, the underworld being conquered, the fallen angels following him, the vampires being enslaved. I didn't see any of this coming. Mother. Father. Was this why the Uzumaki clan? Was this why they were destroyed? Rias asked as she gripped her hands into fists. They heard footsteps on the grass. We don't know. Her father lamented with her and placed a comforting hand on her shoulder. Rias Gremory. I, Yushiwakamaru, have come to bring you a message from my master. There was silence when they turned around and saw one of Naruto's servants. What? What more could he possibly take from me? Haven't I suffered enough? Rias asked with tears starting to gather in her eyes. No, you haven't. My master loved only one woman in his heart, and it was you who twisted that love for your own purposes. Assassin told me of your manipulations. Either way, the queen of your peerage, Akeno, has been put to death by my hand this morning. He wishes to pass the message to you that she attacked him of her own free will, and you will not be punished for her mistake. Yushiwakamaru spoke with a proud smile on her face. Akeno had tried, this morning, to kill Naruto with a stealth attack, but that wouldn't work with her there. Rias collapsed to her knees. I made sure her death was as swift as painless as I could make it, though I don't care if that comforts you or not. I am here to give you a warning. If any of you retaliate, then your deaths will be next. Yushiwakamaru gave her message, and then she turned around and started to walk away. Her mother hugged her as Rias screamed and cried on the ground. For Rias, this had been a bad end. With Naruto. This was too easy. I can't believe it. Your plan worked without a hitch. I'm very proud of you, Naruto. My lord. Ravel spoke as she gave a more respectful, if not attempting a seductive, bow to Naruto. Naruto had destroyed the four thrones of the Devil Kings and had created a new throne from the destroyed remains. Naruto didn't seem happy. I was hoping they would fight back more. Naruto? Ravel asked as she heard that strange tone in his voice. Naruto's throne room was literally covered in the corpses of many people who had attempted to assassinate him this morning. All of them having been killed quickly and painlessly, but without any mercy at all. I'm the king of Earth and the underworld, and with all of the forces I have amassed, I will easily conquer heaven. I don't even need to plan to do it, it could be done with a single large-scale assault now. You could say that I've done it, I'm at the stage where I've become. Atalanta? Naruto asked his second archer as she looked out the window. A small rebel force is sneaking through the forest. Wipe them out. Naruto gave his order to her with a wave of his hand. She took out two arrows and loaded them into her bow, before she aimed into the sky and fired. Soon enough, a rain of arrows that were as many as the number of stars in the sky, started to rain destruction and explosions onto the forest that the rebels were trying to use to hide. Enemies are wiped out. See, nobody can match you. You're the perfect king, unmatched, who can promise victory in every battle. You have become a living legend. You can take on the entire world and win, and now you've done just that, twice over. What is there not to celebrate? Ravel didn't see why he wasn't excited about this. He had achieved such amazing results in such little time. He was the human form of victory. His allies need not fear failing, and his enemies could only hope for a swift defeat of their side. The problem is that I only achieved this as fast as I did thanks to the fact that becoming a devil allowed me to overcome the limits keeping me down. I owe a large part of my victory to Rias Gremory, and I'm not satisfied with that. Foreigner, Abigail Williams. Naruto stated as he summoned her. Yes, master. She appeared. Do you know what multiverse theory is? Naruto asked her, and she shook her head. Every choice, every action, creates a separate reality in which the results of that choice take place. In one world, I killed Akainu with my fist, in this world Yushiwakamaru took her head off of her shoulders in one clean blow. Naruto explained to her. Naruto raised his hand and summoned Featherbreast.
A chicken. A phoenix. A unique phoenix that has the ability to store inside of its tears the memories of others. In another universe, this chicken used her tears to awaken the memories of another version of me when his timeline got reset. I've tasted one of these tears, and I got the memories of that version of me. Naruto explained for Ravel when she questioned why a chicken had been summoned into the world. Ah, that's the chicken. That's the chicken. That's the Miss Featherbreast the First, my outer god told me about her. She travels from timeline to timeline to meet different Narutos who will make use of her tears. Abigail realized as she pointed at the chicken.
Ravel watched as Naruto cut his thumb and allowed Miss Featherbreast the First to drink a single drop of his blood.
Now she has my memories stored inside of her. Let's face it, this world was no fun to conquer. I did everything far too easily. I want more of a challenge next time. Atalanta, Yushiwakamaru, Abigail. Atalanta and Yushiwakamaru, the two of you are to guard Abigail as she takes Featherbreast across space and time, find a version of me who was not manipulated by Rias.
But, Master, if that you drinks her tears, won't he get your memories? Atalanta questioned Naruto on that. I know myself well enough, he will agree with me. He won't see those memories as something full of hatred, he will see them as a second chance to build up a legend even greater than the one I've built up in this world. Atalanta. I'm going to keep working towards my dream in this world for your sake, for the sake of everyone who has crossed my path. Be sure to help him reach for an even brighter future than this one. Naruto stated as he reached towards the sky. As long as Rias does not try to manipulate him in his world, his path will become far different than my path. One day, we will see each other again, and I hope you'll have a great story to tell me. Naruto spoke as he walked out of the throne room. Yes. Yushiwakamaru bowed. I understand, Master. Master. Naruto. Ravel looked towards Naruto with confusion as he had a wide grin on his face that was filled with life once more. Now come on, Ravel. Heaven isn't going to conquer itself. Let's go, onward into the light once more, because I've got a throne to sit on. Naruto laughed as he glanced back. Abigail opened up a portal, and she walked through it with Miss Featherbreast in her arms, with Atalanta and Yushiwakamaru following after her. Naruto's laughter filled the castle. It was time to make a better ending. Yushiwakamaru had many questions. Foreigner was stronger than either her or Atalanta were in pure strength, so why did Naruto assign the two of them to be her guards for a trip to another timeline? That was a concerning question, but a more concerning question was why did Naruto not assign Assassin, Saber, or Lancer to do the job as they were his strongest servants along with Foreigner? Atalanta didn't question her orders. They traveled through a rainbow of colors as they slipped through space and time itself, traveling through the very nature of science and magic. Sometimes she would see a tentacle peek out of one of the flying colors that traveled past her. Archer. Why do you think Master picked us for this role, when there are stronger servants? Yushi Wakamaru asked. Atalanta was holding the memory chicken. She herself was holding onto a bottle that contained a tear that had been diluted with water so that her master would not be overwhelmed by all of his previous timeline's memories all at once. Abigail was leading the way, her body surrounded by gray and black tentacles, her white skin turned gray and her outfit transformed completely. She guided their path through the ever-changing rainbow of colors, through the void of colors, and through the complete absence of everything and anything. They were everywhere and nowhere at the same time. It was only their spirit bodies being spirit bodies that allowed them to exist in this space at the moment. The fact Feather Breast was still in one piece at all was a startling amount of insight into just what she was. We are strong, but not so strong that he would be required to have us to complete his goals in his own timeline. Strong enough to do this job, and help this next master. Atalanta gave her insight. Her insight wasn't helpful actually, since Yushi Wakamaru didn't really believe her words. She hadn't been around Naruto long enough to have that great of an insight into his choices. She met him days before he ruled over hell and earth and was moving on to conquer heaven. Foreigner. Master is master, and I am more linked to master than either of you. I am also master in that way, and this timeline will reject my existence more than it will either of you. Because you are not master like I am. Abigail spoke with a spiked grin. Atalanta raised an eyebrow. What? The world itself hates Master, and it hates those of us who were given form thanks to Master. His power makes up our bodies, but the two of you have bodies that are made up originally of magic that is not that of Master. So the world doesn't register you as much. Not to mention, I wouldn't be strong enough to defeat Altars of Saber, Assassin, or Lancer if they came along. I have no true altar. Abigail stated as she looked towards the nothingness before them. They came out of the void, or rather they were ripped out of the void. They stood on nothing and everything. There were countless floating crystals of shining and dim colors everywhere, and yet, nowhere at the same time. They had not yet reached their destination, and when Yushi Wakamaru reached out to touch a crystal, her hand phased right through it as if it didn't exist. These crystals. Are the physical manifestations. No? Atalanta didn't think that was right. They both exist and do not exist, they are concepts given image. But not form itself. They are the very concepts that make up everything. This is the concept of a timeline in which Master does not have Excalibur. You can see them play out, but you can't interact because they have no form. This is the concept of victory that is tied to Excalibur. There are infinite concepts, but our eyes can only see concepts that are related to us. Abigail stated as she reached out and pointed to a concept that neither of them could see were there. Yushi Wakamaru saw a concept of her first master not being killed by Ilya, but Abigail didn't seem able to see that concept, just like she couldn't see the concept that Abigail was pointing to either. They could all three see the concepts that involved Naruto though, as they were related to him on the level of concepts. This is me, but, Atalanta looked at herself. I can. That's not a concept. Abigail shouted as she jumped back when a black arrow came flying at them and stabbed into nothingness. A second arrow came flying and Atalanta shot her arrow and blocked it between them. Atalanta Altar. The world doesn't want us here. Yushi Wakamaru had a corrupted sword at her throat, and she glanced behind herself and saw a corrupted, altered version of herself. She flicked her sword out of its sheath and it stopped her neck from getting slit. She grabbed its handle and jumped away from herself. Berserkers. They are us, but as berserkers, Yushi Wakamaru realized when herself came rushing at her with a look of utter hatred. Where was Foreigner's berserker at? I am an existence outside of the domain of the world, thus, the world cannot alter or reproduce me like it can the two of you or Master's other servants. At the same time, my powers barely work here. And I can't use my noble phantasm at all. Abigail was almost completely helpless. She could use her basic attacks, but that was it. Feather Breast carrying the tear bottle landed in her arms. You sided with a child murderer. Atalanta Alter screamed as she got her claws out and rushed towards Atalanta. Atalanta readied her bow and aimed it up. Phoebus Catastrophe. She released her noble phantasm up into the air, and two arrows turned into millions of arrows that started to fall down towards her and her altar. Not a single arrow came even close to hitting herself, but her altar could only dodge most of the arrows, with several of them sticking into her body. She didn't stop her charge though. She was just as fast as she was, but with her body transformed like that she was no doubt far physically superior. Why is my altar's chest larger than mine? Atalanta thought as she looked at the modest-sized chest her alter had, and she glanced down at her own completely flat chest. What concept made this version of her have a large chest? Yushiwakamaru and her own alter were engaged in a super high-speed bout of jumping and slashing at each other, at speeds that were slower than Atalanta's own speed. Slower, but her close combat powers with her sword made her a larger threat. This was why they were foreigners' guardians. Die. Die, so that I can replace you, and kill Naruto myself. Ushi alter shouted at her original, who blocked 12 slashes of hers with 12 slashes of her own blade. Yushiwakamaru got several cuts across her body, but so did her alter as well. The two of them were perfectly evenly matched in all forms of combat. Her alter was more violent in nature, making her hard to predict, but her own strategic mind and calmer demeanor allowed her to evenly fight against herself. Yushiwakamaru and Atalanta were forced back to back. How do we win against foes we are perfectly matched against? Yushiwakamaru asked her partner in protecting. Foreigner, find the concept that we need and open the portal there, and do it fast. Atalanta shouted out her own orders to the superior servant. She looked around and Abigail was standing at a crystal she couldn't see, with a key in her hand. She inserted the key into the object that she couldn't see, and a gateway opened up where the crystal should have been. This timeline has a 92.9% similarity to the one we are leaving. The only variation is the concept that Rias Gremory or Sona Sitri will try to manipulate Naruto. Abigail stated as she was given the amount of similarity at the current point in time by comparing it to the concept of her own timeline. You two, grab Feather Breast in the bottle, and hurry through the gateway. My job is over now. Abigail called out to them. Yushiwakamaru nodded and rushed towards Abigail and grabbed the bottle, rushing right through the portal without hesitating. Atalanta rushed and stood by Abigail's side, with Feather Breast jumping onto her shoulder. She raised her bow when she saw Ushi alter and her own alter turn towards them. You can't beat them, and I won't allow you to try. Atalanta stated to her partner. I'm not going to try and beat them, I'm Master's servant. I can't make a contract with Master on the other timeline. When I die I'll go back to the timeline I came from. Two of me can't exist together under Master. But those two can't be allowed to go through the portal. After you go through the portal, I have to close it here to stop them from going through it. Servants who don't need masters. Abigail summoned tentacles and prepared for combat. Atalanta was keeping the altars at bay with her arrows to prevent them from getting close to them. But it's okay. Dying is going to hurt. But when I die, Master can just summon me again. If you and Ryder die in this place, Master can't summon you. You need to go through the portal. Because if a servant dies here without a contract to their master, they will be removed from all of history. You will stop being a concept. Abigail stated as a tentacle grabbed Atalanta and threw her through the portal. In slow motion, Atalanta watched as Abigail smiled at her and reached towards the portal with a key. Atalanta was halfway through the portal when she saw the alters rushing towards portal and Abigail. Her bow arm was already through the portal, and she was unable to pull it out as she got sucked through to another timeline. Three arrows stuck in Abigail's back, and Atalanta alter reached the portal as Abigail started to turn the key. Yushiwakamaru's sword started to approach her small body, and that was the last thing that Atalanta saw happen before she was fully sucked through the portal and tossed out on the other side where Yushiwakamaru was. Abigail! Atalanta shouted out in worry. Atalanta alter appeared before her and Yushiwakamaru with grit teeth. We have no time for you. Leave now and don't bother us again. If you approach out Master, we will kill you together, Yushiwakamaru declared as she pointed her sword at Atalanta alter's face. The woman looked at her for a second and grit her teeth, and she looked at Atalanta and saw her readying her bow. Abigail. I hope Master will reward her in their timeline for her hard work. I won't allow her suffering to go in vain. This timeline will be a better one. Atalanta took aim at her alter. There was a long pause. Atalanta alter jumped up to the trees and took her spirit form, escaping them and retreating from combat completely. Well, Master wanted more challenges, and it would seem this world has an extra challenge for this. Wait. Our contract with Master was revoked. And we. Oh, we need to go and find Master in this timeline fast before our magical power disappears. Yushiwakamaru realized with widened eyes. They were servants with broken contracts. Not servants with no contracts or with no need for contracts. They had a strict time limit for how long they could remain in the world now that they had a need for a supply of magical energy. Atalanta closed her eyes and she sensed the area. Master's magical energy is that way. Since I was originally summoned with the purpose of hunting him down, I can sense him no matter where he goes. I was summoned for the hunt. Atalanta could see another reason why she had been picked. Her hunting skills and the purpose of her original summoning made her the perfect person to deliver herself and Ryder to this timeline's Naruto. They started to run. Somewhere in jail, Naruto sneezed several times, hoping that the girls who accused him of crimes he didn't commit would get what was coming to them as he started to fall asleep. He didn't know what was in store for him. Yushiwakamaru had heard about it from Medusa, but she had yet to ever experience this side of Naruto for herself. Naruto's distrust and dislike of women. When she and Atalanta reached and broke into the jail cell that Naruto was being kept in for the crime he did not commit, they had been unaware of the fact that at this point in time there was almost no way that Naruto was going to believe them. He looked at them with distrust as they tried to get him to drink the tear water so that he could gain the memories of his other self from the other timeline. What can we do? Be quiet. You say that I have a sacred gear, something that allows me to summon heroes from the past. Very well. Naruto opened his hand. From their story, his sacred gear took the form of a book that he could summon at will. Naruto concentrated and he thought of his dream to rule over Japan, and eventually the entire world. He focused hard on his goal, using that as a focus to try and bring out a great power in himself. If your words hold any merit to them, the second that I summon my sacred gear, you will toss that bottle on the ground and shatter it. Naruto stated as he glanced over to them. Wh what? Master, this bottle contains your memories that you wanted us to give to you. This is our order to you from yourself. I am a king, the king who will rule this world one day. I will achieve my goals without the help of a version of me who couldn't find satisfaction with his life. He failed to achieve what we both desire. Naruto's hand started to glow, and a book appeared in his hand. Naruto looked at the book and opened it up. We can't disobey. Please, at least take a sip from it. Just enough to give you flashbacks. I'll destroy the rest. Yushiwakamaru stated as she tried to get Naruto to take the bottle from her. Naruto looked at her and then he looked at his sacred gear with a more thoughtful expression. Please, at least remember enough of the bond that we shared when I slaughtered an army for you. Please praise me. I'll do whatever you command of me. Yushiwakamaru stated as she took a knee and bowed to Naruto. Naruto glanced at Atalanta. I am here for my own dreams and goals, which align nicely with your goals. In our world, you slaughtered armies for your dream. You attained everything but you weren't happy. Allow us to serve you once more. Atalanta bowed to him and offered her bow towards him. Use this and strike me down now if you want. But a more vile version of me has followed us to this world. She has my memories, and my knowledge of your servants. Atalanta stated with a glance towards his eyes. Both of them glowed as Naruto renewed the contracts with them. I summon thee. Rider Medusa. Naruto stated as the female form of his original rider appeared in front of him. Yushiwakamaru and Atalanta looked at each other with some surprise at Naruto's first pick for the servant that he wanted to summon. In their timeline, he had picked Jack the Ripper. But this time he had picked his rider. You say in your timeline, there is a girl who manipulates me into ending my humanity. Rider Medusa. The most beautiful, who was punished by the gods for her beauty and banished from society. Cursed with eyes that turn a man to stone. Are you completely loyal to me? Naruto asked the beautiful woman. She looked in Naruto's general direction, both of her eyes were covered fully and she couldn't see. I will die any number of deaths for you, my master. Your happiness and protection is all that I desire, and I will offer everything to protect your ability to smile. Medusa affirmed for Naruto. Allow me to faithfully do for you what I was unable to do for my sisters. Medusa spoke more on the matter. Naruto glanced at Yushiwakamaru. Minamoto no Yoshitsune. One of Japan's greatest commanders with fame to rival even Oda. Yushiwakamaru. Take Medusa to this red-haired woman. Do not interfere with Medusa, and Medusa, I want you to test her to see if she is a worthy ally. Naruto sat down on his jail cell bed and he watched as Atalanta nodded to him and vanished, desummoning herself now that she had affirmed her contract with Naruto. Yushiwakamaru felt Naruto was sending her the bare minimum of magical energy to keep her active, but that was it. Will you take this bottle? Yushiwakamaru asked as she placed the bottle on the bed. Medusa just listened to the conversation silently.
I will take a single sip of this bottle. After all, apparently last night I summoned. Assassin, you said, in my sleep. So any day now, I will be freed from this jail cell anyway. After that point, we will head to Kuo City. Once I meet this red-haired girl in person, after Medusa tests her, then I will decide if I trust you or not. Naruto pointed a finger of distrust at Yushiwakamaru.
She smiled brightly. Yes, master. I will not interfere in the slightest with Medusa-senpai. I will do my very best to earn your respect and praise. If I find this red-haired girl to not be worthy of being your ally, what am I to do to her? Medusa asked Naruto for more clarification. Should I kill her? Medusa questioned his desires. Yushiwakama frowned. Of course you should. I myself was the one who beheaded her queen when she tried to attack Master. Anyone who stands in Master's way must be killed without mercy. This world belongs to Master, it just doesn't know it. No, if she isn't worthy, just leave her alone. I don't want any deaths that can be avoided. I want to take over the world with as few deaths as possible. I am the king of the world, and that makes every person on this world part of my kingdom. A king killing their citizens should be avoided. Naruto interrupted Yushiwakamaru and looked towards Medusa with narrowed eyes when he saw the smile appear on her face. Yushiwakamaru saluted Naruto. Sorry, master, I got ahead of myself. Killing in your honor is my greatest honor, but if you wish for peace, then that is my wish as well. Yushiwakamaru had never seen this side of Naruto. She had only seen him as an honorable king. She had never met him before he had become king. This Naruto was far less twisted. Right, he hasn't met Rias yet, she didn't twist his heart. Yushiwakamaru realized on her own. Medusa reached out with her hand and gently touched Naruto's head. Very well, I'll stop short of killing them. Yushiwakamaru, I am unaware of where Kuo is. I will rely on your guidance. Please lead me there as soon as possible. Medusa spoke as she opened the cell door and walked out like it was nothing. She was followed by her fellow rider. Okay, Medusa-senpai. Why do you refer to me as senpai? Medusa questioned her, Yushiwakamaru now taking the lead in where they were walking. You are his first rider, and I am his second. That makes you my senpai, so out of respect for your place, I will address you with the proper respect. Yushiwakamaru knew her place as the second rider and not the original. She got a nod from Medusa, before she looked back at Naruto in the cell. Master. I fully believe that Rias Gremory should be killed now. The second she tries to manipulate you in this timeline, I will behead her myself. Then, I will take whatever punishment that you wish to give me. Yushiwakamaru thought to herself, noticing that Naruto laid back on the bed and relaxed. Medusa was paying attention to her. She was suspicious of this second rider. Rias Gremory didn't know it, but very soon she was going to come face to face with a dangerous monster. I want to cut her head off again. Yushiwakamaru was looking right at Akeno, who was still alive in this timeline, and at the moment she seemed like a pleasant girl as she served Medusa tea. She wanted to add Akeno's head to the one that she already had, maybe put it on a stick or something, she didn't know. She just wanted to kill all of her master's enemies as soon as possible and get that big-handed, warm head pat that was waiting for her. She's staring at me pretty hard, Akeno thought. Rias had visitors who came out of nowhere. Neither of them had spoken a single word, just sat down. Are you going to speak? Rias asked as she looked at the purple-haired beauty in front of her. I'm waiting for Kaneko and Kiba to get back before I start. Medusa spoke fairly. She was to test Rias and her group, which meant waiting until the entire group was there. She had no hostility at all towards this group of people and wasn't going to make it a point to be overly hostile towards them until she was made to attack them. Rias was put on guard, but her visitor wasn't hostile towards her, so she allowed the knowledge to slide. Your partner seems to be of a different mind. Rias looked towards Ushi. She seems to have a bad history with you, one that I don't quite understand. Medusa didn't know what to say about that. Rias tilted her head in confusion. We have a history? Not yet, but another you in another time has done something unforgivable against my master. You are not worth the time that this version of my master is giving to you. Yushiwakamaru didn't hide anything, but she didn't exactly explain it in a way that Rias could easily comprehend it. All in all, her explanation left Rias with more questions than answers. Last time, I only beheaded the her. Yushiwakamaru gave the sack attached to her waist armor a pat.
Akeno's head had been her trophy for her services to Naruto, and she had taken it with her into this world as well. She had gotten a mage to cast spells on it so that it would never decay, so that she could appreciate the look on Akeno's face forever.
Akeno held her neck. What? I'm sorry, but other timelines. Other master. It's hard to believe. Rhea stopped talking when Ushi opened the sack at her waist and dropped the severed head onto the table. Instantly, Rhea was standing at attention in horror as she saw her best friend's severed head and the expression on it. Akeno collapsed onto her ass in fright, holding her neck with both of her hands now, looking somewhat fearfully at Ushi as the woman put the head back in the sack. Of course, Master doesn't want me to kill you in this timeline. So I will not kill you so long as you are not his enemy or I do not perceive any of your actions as those of an enemy. Ushi explained as she put her hands together. Medusa was silent. Kaneko teleported back into the room, just in time to not see the severed head, but she was put on alert when she saw Rias and Akeno were both ready for a fight. She jumped in front of Rias, at the ready for a fight as well. Medusa sipped the tea in front of her. Rider. Do not provoke a deathmatch, we aren't here for that. Our orders are clear, if Rias wishes for a deathmatch, we can oblige. But as servants, killing us will just be a minor inconvenience. Our master can resummon us. Medusa spoke to Ushi, but her words were hinting that Rias didn't need to fight them yet. That killing them now or even trying to kill them would be ultimately pointless. My name is Rider right now. Medusa spoke to Ushi. Rider Senpei. It would be best to kill them all now before they can hurt our master. They are just going to hold him back. You don't understand. You haven't seen our master in my timeline. He was strong, ruthless, but so very kind. He conquered and conquered until everything was his. Ushi urged Medusa to try and see things her way. Medusa shook her head. What's going on? Kaneko asked Rias under her breath. I have no idea. With her saying that, Kiba finished his request as well and appeared back in the clubroom. Medusa gently placed her cup on the table, outside. The window shattered as Rias was sent flying out the now broken window, with both of Medusa's feet firmly planted in her stomach. She was both shocked and surprised by the sudden attack, before she landed on the ground. Medusa landed on her feet as Akeno, Kiba, and Kaneko all jumped out of the window and joined on the battle. Ushi jumped up on top of the roof though. I've never seen Medusa Senpei battle before, this could be good. And she might accidentally kill them. I can only hope. Ushi sat down and unsheathed her sword, watching the battle with excited eyes. Rias stood back up holding her stomach, already gathering magic in her hand. Medusa was surrounded, and Kiba was now holding two swords, so she created two large nails with long chains coming out of the back of them. She didn't know the abilities of her enemies, but since Kaneko was in a boxing stance, Kiba had swords, and Akeno had lightning magic around her fingers pointed at her, she could guess what each of them specialized in. She undid the binding over her eyes and allowed it to fall to the ground, but she kept her eyes covered anyway with her arm. She was gone. She's fast. Kaneko, be careful. Rias shouted as Medusa escaped the center of the formation they had her surrounded in, and ran a literal circle around them. She threw her magic at where Medusa was about to be, but she jumped like a dancer with grace that should be unreal when running at such speeds. She's too fast for me to hit with a small attack, but I need a minute or two to get a wide area spell with enough coverage to hit her for sure. Rias took her stance and gathered magic in the palms of her hands. Kiba rushed at Medusa, and he hooked his arm around Kaneko to drag her along. The second Medusa's foot touched the ground from her landing, she appeared behind Kiba when he swung his sword at her. He dropped Kaneko and she raised both of her arms up, blocking a stab from Medusa for Kiba, so that he could get a hit on her. She flipped backwards and his blade soared between her legs during her flip, and like that she was on the move again. She ran towards Akeno as she took aim at her with her lightning. Akeno froze in place when she made glancing eye contact with Medusa, and her hand started to turn into stone. She couldn't even move so much as a finger, before Medusa's legs glowed purple as veins of magical energy appeared. Speeding up to maximum speed, and used a monstrous amount of strength and kicked Akeno full in the chest with both of her feet. Gak. Akeno had no words as blood spilled from her mouth, being sent flying as a crater appeared on the ground underneath them. She slammed into the side of the school building, crashed through the brick wall, and then proceeded to keep moving until she was halfway through the building itself. When she got far enough away from Medusa, her body stopped turning to stone, and she was able to reverse the process by charging up her magical energy. She couldn't breathe and she couldn't move, and in the end, she was defeated as she passed out on the ground. She will live. I made sure to avoid hitting her heart. I only collapsed her right lung. She's a devil, she can survive that level of damage. She will need to be healed though. Medusa stated as she returned to battle. She and Kiba crossed blades. The small one, Kaneko, jumped from behind Kiba with both of her hands above her head, preparing to crush Medusa's skull with her fists. She swung her arms around, and her chains wrapped around Kaneko as Kiba was forced to dodge out of the way of her arms. Medusa plucked several hairs out of her head, and transformed them into long chains that wrapped around boulders that had been knocked out of the ground from her double kick earlier. She moved quickly around Kaneko as her hands slammed into the ground where she had been, and Kiba was already moving on her. Before Kaneko could rip the chains off of her, Medusa jumped high into the air and slammed all of the boulders into Kaneko, trapping her inside a prison of stone. Her arms and legs were stuck in place, with only her head remaining unsealed. She landed next to her head, and gave Kaneko a swift kick to the temple, knocking her out cold second. "Hold her off for another minute, Kiba, I'm almost ready. Easier said than done, she's faster and more skilled than I am. I couldn't hit her even when I was working with Kaneko," Kiba thought as he clashed blades five times with Medusa. She ducked and weaved under his attacks, and three of her own stabs got him in the right arm, right shoulder, and his left leg. Instantly, he was dropped by over half of his speed, and he was prevented from using two swords at the same time. He placed his good hand on the ground, and dozens of swords burst from the ground in response, but Medusa had predicted it and rushed towards him in the same burst of speed that she used against Akeno. She avoided his surprising attack, and kicked him in the jaw, knocking him out as he collapsed onto his side. Medusa turned to Rias. "That is an impressive amount of magical power you've built up with only 45 seconds to charge up."
Medusa could sense a massive energy inside of Rias and concentrated into her hands. She planned on finishing her off with a single attack. Quote dot dot dot. "Your magic seems focused on explosive attack power, but your attacks aren't fast enough to hit me. A wide area spanning attack that I can't avoid then, but what about your followers?" Medusa asked as she gestured to her knocked out Akeno, Kaneko, and Kiba.
Rias placed her hands together. Huge magical power surged forwards to Medusa, but Rias kept it from going towards the school where Akeno was inside of, and where Kaneko was knocked out. The attack didn't hit Kiba either, since he was low to the ground and she aimed her attack above ground level. She aimed very carefully. Medusa took advantage of this and ducked, running very low to the ground, right underneath the magical attack. By the time Rias' attack had ended, it was too late and Medusa was in front of her, wrapping her up in chains by the ankles. Rias was dragged off of her feet and swung around, before the back of her head slammed into a tree with enough force to break the tree and knock her out. The battle was over. Medusa picked her blindfold up off of the ground and wrapped it around her eyes once more. "I'll report that you are quite skilled and strong, but your teamwork is very poor. You each specialize in a specific field, but when it comes to actually working together, you don't use very much strategy that takes advantage of each unique fighting style. When it comes to raw power, you possess more power than I do. But you are woefully lacking in your ability to properly make use of those powers." Medusa had almost nothing but praises for Rias and her peerage. Each of them were skilled and strong, but she was far more skilled than them, and she was proud of her speed for sure. They lacked real battle experience to allow them to take advantage of that training. She would inform Naruto that she found this group of people to be non-threatening to him, people he could join without worrying about them being capable of rising up against him. "They could be useful. I see. It would seem that Medusa Senpei is even faster than I am. And she can enhance her strength with her monstrous strength skill for brief moments. This is Master's first rider." Ushi smiled in pride as she vanished, desummoning herself now that the mission was complete. Medusa desummoned herself as well. One drop of the memories that he had from another timeline included a few details. It included the date that he went to Kuo City to go to school there, and it included the date that he had conquered Earth. It included a memory of him being loved and helped by a girl named Asia Argento, and his friendship with a boy named Issei Hyodo. It included the fact that he had slaughtered people in the hundreds of thousands. "Master, where are we going exactly?" Medusa asked as she rode her Pegasus through the bitterly cold skies. She had reported her results to Naruto, but he had not told her what he had planned to do. He had changed slightly after drinking a single drop of his memories from a previous timeline, a different world pretty much. He had spent 30 minutes thinking, before he had grinned. "Atalanta. How far are we to the target?" Naruto didn't speak to Medusa. Atalanta was standing behind Naruto. 10 minutes away at this pace. This will allow you to take over the world. this secret weapon? Atalanta asked with a raised eyebrow. He had already taken over the world in another timeline, so she didn't know why he needed to get a secret weapon, unless she had her suspicions. I will keep the promise the previous me made to you. This time I will conquer the world without a single child dying. I will give the world the freedom I gave it in the other timeline, without the needless bloodshed. For that, I need this secret weapon. Naruto answered her suspicions. Medusa was curious, but she kept her silence and followed her orders. She landed in front of a large factory in a surprisingly well-built building that stood in the middle of a snow-covered village. Her Pegasus vanished as they landed in the snow, and she noticed that Naruto just crossed his arms and walked towards the factory. Master, it's quite cold. Do you not need a jacket? Medusa asked, worried for his health. It was snow as far as the eye could see, and the sun was hidden behind the thickest of clouds imaginable. There was no heat anywhere. It was amazing that a village was here at all in this snow-covered wasteland. This secret weapon is? Atalanta asked. Naruto chuckled. It's not truly a weapon, but I plan to weaponize him. Speak of the devil, hello there old man, it's fine to see you. Though I can't say I saw you before either. Naruto saw a large male figure hit the ground in front of him. A blood-red coat that was lined with white that was more fresh than even the snow, his arms thicker than tree branches, his beard going down to the middle of his chest, and his voice rough but soothing. The man towered over Naruto, and he adjusted his glasses and stared at Naruto with eyes filled with both kindness and unease. Uzumaki Naruto. Are you upset that you have been on the naughty list for the past few years? Santa Claus. Hello Santa, I've always wanted to have a chat with you. I've come to offer you a choice, join me by force or by will. Naruto stated as he extended his hand to Santa. Naruto's secret weapon was Santa Claus. To conquer the world without spilling any needless blood, he needed this man to join him. He didn't actually need the man himself, he needed the man's ability. Still, they were one and the same at this point. I ref you, Santa froze in place. His body slowly started to turn to stone as out of the corner of his eye he made eye contact with Medusa, and he averted his eyes, but it was already too late. Medusa slowed down the rate his body turned to stone, but his arms and legs had already transfigured into mineral. He turned his head to Naruto and he saw that Naruto wasn't smiling. By force or by will? You are the man who can travel to every home in a single night.
You have knowledge of every man, women, and child and their deeds. I have need of that. Now, I don't even want to spill your blood, but I wasn't satisfied with how I took over the world in a different timeline, too much bloodshed, and not enough challenge. Naruto had a grin on his face. He didn't know exactly how he took over the world last time, but this time he was going to make things far more fun and far less bloodthirsty.
Taking over the world using a weaponized Santa seemed like a good way to start things off, and he only had 4 days to do it. 4 days until he was going to Kuo and meet Asia, the smile from his memories that warmed his heart. Medusa. And Atalanta. I can sense Jean and Artoria. I sense. You've awakened your sacred gear. Santa stated as he looked at Naruto with a new feeling in his eyes. He now understood how serious this was truly. Santa makes children smile. Correct? Atalanta asked Naruto quietly. He nodded. It's simple, all I need you to do is take Medusa to the home of every single politician, king, queen, and member of every royal family. She won't spill a single drop of blood, but she will leave behind a message for the entire world. A handwritten note from me detailing what will happen if the world does not surrender to the man king who rules from the shadows. Naruto stated his very simple plan. Santa furrowed his brow. People will not, the world is ruled by those who make the law, but if I rule those who make the law, then I rule the world. It's simple, either every person who rules follows my rules, or they become a statue. It's very simple, but very effective. And if it all happens in a single night, it will spread fear. I don't need to kill a single innocent person. And once my rule is established, they can be freed from their prisons. Naruto didn't need a complicated plan for this timeline. He didn't need to proclaim himself the king to the entire world, not yet anyway, not before every single law that he wanted passed could get passed. Once he had restructured this entire world into the world that he wanted through the use of controlling all of the world's lawmaking powers would be proclaim himself the king of the world. Master. Thank you. Medusa thanked Naruto. She didn't want to kill anyone she didn't have to, and Naruto's plan meant that she might not have to kill anyone. She could just turn them to stone and then later find a way to turn them back. If they couldn't be saved, then at least the number of deaths would be quite low. Atalanta smiled a bright and genuine smile. In that plan, not a single child has to die.
I'm keeping my promise to you, to make the world a place where children can smile. You've provided me with a good challenge. Now then, Santa, either you can use your sleigh for my goal, or I can have a servant of my choice become the new Santa in your place. You don't have a choice. Naruto offered his hand to Santa as the stone started to turn back into flesh. The man took a knee from the shock of having his limbs back to him.
He was forced to think of his options. Atalanta was just happy. A world where children can smile. He made this new plan. After getting a few of his memories, he made a plan that could make me happy. This plan must have been a challenge for him. His smile is quite genuine, Atalanta thought. Medusa covered her eyes. Master, you want to make the world bow to you, but if you rule from the shadows.
Nothing stays in the shadows forever, but instead of just focusing all of my attention on ruling the world, I want to chase a smile, the smile that the other me found salvation in. I want to make that girl happy. I want to put my faith in a woman one more time. To do that, I need to put my pride to the side for a while. Naruto pushed down his own urges to proclaim to the world that he was their ruler. That would come with time, but instead of chasing for the world, he would chase the girl that made his other self happy. Still, he did promise to make the world a place for children to smile and for Atalanta, so he couldn't give up his desires in this timeline for the sake of those who followed him.
Medusa nodded, and said no more. Very well. I have no choice. Master, he gave up too easily. I think, Atalanta raised her bow up against Santa, but Naruto waved his hand and made her lower it. Santa can't lie, he must be honest. If he says he will help, then he has to help. He also understands that if he goes against me, then he can never bring smiles to young kids ever again. He won't be able to spread Christmas to the world. He can't stand the thought of unhappiness in the world. Naruto could understand the man. You're mad that I never visited you, Santa stated as he stared Naruto in the eyes. Naruto nodded his head. I've never once in my life had faith in you. Because, if Santa could really give me happiness, then he would have given me a family. So for the years you couldn't give me a family, I'm going to make you help give me the world. Naruto stated with a forced smile. Naruto took some amusement out of forcing Santa to give him the gift that he wanted. I can't bring back the dead. There was, he stopped speaking. It didn't have to be my mother and father, I would have been happy with any family at all. For an orphan, the parents who gave birth to us don't matter. It's the family who cares for us in their hearts that matter. And I never got that. Why should I care about a woman who I've never met, or a father who I don't remember? Naruto asked coldly and bitterly. Atalanta was taken back for a moment, but the woman connected to Naruto's very soul nodded her head in understanding. Medusa understood Naruto's desire for love and family very much, but at the same time she could tell his actions weren't fueled by his desire for family. Naruto didn't need to start a war to conquer the world. He just needed to conquer those made the law. 2 days left until the memories he got said that this Issei person was going to get killed. He had conquered Earth by weaponizing Santa Claus and forcing the politicians of the world to sign into law the laws that he wished to be passed. As it stood, he was the secret king of the world that stood atop a mountain of statues. Uzumaki Island. The Uzumaki Vault, the vault that contained all of the treasures that the Uzumaki clan had amassed over the centuries. It was an ancient-looking vault on the outside, with an infinite amount of space to store items on the inside. Master. You already have Excalibur, why do you need to open the vault? Lancer asked, as she was summoned for her horse, to give him a ride across the island to the vault. Of course, she knew of this vault very well. The vault contained the sealed-away Merlin deep within its depths, and it contained so many treasures that she believed there to be no end to the amount of objects inside of it. Surely Excalibur is a weapon worthy of you. Lancer would have really liked to say what she felt. Why don't you use the weapon I left behind? She was his father, and he was the heir to Excalibur and the throne that she had left behind. She would have liked for him to use her well-known weapon, instead of risk freeing Merlin from the vault if he happened to notice that it was being opened. Why are you afraid of me opening the vault? Unless you know the history behind this vault? Naruto asked her with a grin. Very well. Long ago there was a king who collected all of the world's treasures, but after his death all of his treasures were stolen and scattered across the world. The Uzumaki clan heard this legend, and spent years recollecting those treasures. There are only a few weapons in existence that this vault does not contain. Excalibur is a sword forged by the planet, so this vault doesn't contain this sword. Naruto turned his yo-yo into a golden sword and he raised it up. He had a soft smile on his face as he looked at the door to the vault.
Lancer nodded. Naruto was explaining something to her that she had full knowledge of. The Uzumaki clan had heard the legends of this empty treasury, and sought out to collect all of the treasures of the treasury and bring them back home. The fact that they collected the original versions of every legendary weapon, and not just the downgraded versions, was something very few people knew.
The Uzumaki could not use weapons that were made by man. When an Uzumaki unlocked a chakra gate and learned to channel their magical power, man-made weapons were unable to contain their power. They required weapons that were forged in legend. Gilgamesh, humanity's first hero. Of course, he was the worst kind of king you could imagine. The kind who forced his will upon the citizens instead of allowing them true freedom. I wish one of my servants had been Gilgamesh, if only so I could defeat him myself. It wasn't meant to be though. Naruto touched the door. The door opened up, and Lancer saw once more the inside of the vault. Treasure as far as the eye could see. She saw the original Caliburn, the unnamed sword that legend would name Caliburn. She saw the original Guy Bolg. She saw untold numbers of legendary weapons in their original forms before they were reforged by legends. Anyway, I'm not seeking a new weapon. I will still use Excalibur. Instead, I'm seeking something else. Naruto raised his hand up. He thought about the treasure he wanted. It came flying out of the stack of treasures, further away than the eye could see, and landed in his hand. It was the key to the vault, and Naruto smirked when he saw the key, before he tossed it onto the ground and crushed it. Then why are we here? I wanted to see the vault. I wanted to see the treasures that Gilgamesh spent his entire life chasing. I wanted to see the treasures my dead clan recollected over time. I'm honestly impressed. But this just goes to show how pathetic Gilgamesh and my clan were. To Gilgamesh, they were nameless tools for him to use. For my clan, they were treasures to be used as weapons. All of the people who filled this vault are dead, and they couldn't take the contents of this vault to the afterlife with them. They sure are pathetic wasting their lives for this. Naruto stated as he looked at the untold amounts of treasure. Naruto raised Excalibur above his head, and light gathered to it. Hours later, there was practically nothing left. Naruto had spent hours unleashing blast after blast of Excalibur into the vault, destroying nearly everything inside with the exception of a small mountain of treasures that was being protected by very strong magic. The mountain of treasure was only 17 feet tall, not a real mountain but still a large pile of treasure. Behind that treasure was Merlin, who was practically shitting his robes as he used his magic to protect the barrier between himself and the fucking insane Uzumaki who was destroying everything in the treasure vault. All of that treasure. Gone. So much is gone. Your family spent their entire lives. They wasted their lives. When they died, they left a full vault filled with treasure that nobody was going to see.
If anything, I'm just sending this treasure to them by destroying it. Since some of the treasure is stubborn, I'll call it quits here. We're just here so that I could cut my attachment to the dreams my family had. Naruto now had no reason to value this vault. Only a small stack of powerful weapons remained inside of it, and Naruto had no intention of allowing himself to follow in his family's footsteps and obsessing over shiny weapons.
Lancer felt so much pride. You know you just destroyed most of the most valuable stash of treasure in all of history? Lancer asked Naruto. She wanted to be sure he knew what he did. Humanity is the greatest treasure, and I own humanity. My treasury is this entire planet, and every living thing on it. Mine is the only treasury that can show me their smiling faces. I have an ever-expanding treasury, one that can reach beyond the stars. Naruto had the brightest twinkle in his eye as the sun was reflected in them. Lancer smiled under her helmet, knowing that Naruto was absolutely correct. The smile that a king could bring to their people was the greatest treasure she could imagine as well, and she had owned her own treasury of weapons and valuables. She fought and died for her people, and lived for them. The world that she left behind, the legend that she weaved for the ages, that was a treasure that withstood the test of time and was valued by all who held her legend in their hearts. Why is it you wish to be king of the world? Lancer asked Naruto. She didn't quite understand his goal. I want to make a better world, a free world with a king that is beloved by the people.
That is all there is to it. Still, It seems the other me from that other timeline became king in a way that left him unsatisfied, from the few memories I got. I got important dates and important people, and a few flashes. In 2 days a boy I will value as a friend is going to get killed, and a girl I value will die not long after him. I will protect both of them. Naruto rubbed the back of his head in thought.
His other self had accomplished the world and more, but hadn't been satisfied, so Naruto wanted to not only become the ruler of everything, but do so in a way that left him satisfied with how he had done it. Why bother? You haven't met them yet. Because, the other me held them dear, and I want to know why. This aching in my chest started when I got those flashes of memory involving them. Anyway, let's go back to Japan. As long as I'm human, my body's potential is going to remain locked, isn't it? I need to fix that. Naruto stated with purpose. No matter how much he trained, the world was going to apply more pressure on him to weaken him as long as he was human. He had trained his entire life and he was still only stronger than the athletic human. He should be way stronger than he was with how much he had trained, but now he was aware of the fact that the world hated him and hated him growing stronger. The stronger he got, the more limiters that the world placed on his human body. You plan to join Rias? Even after she and her group were defeated by Medusa? Lancer asked with a raised brow under her helmet. Naruto nodded. Yes, they are perfect for that reason. With them, I can destroy them at any second I want to. If they ever get in my way, I can remind them that I can have them killed at any time. It's only with a group like that, that I can unleash my potential and retain a level of freedom. Naruto stated with a grin on his face. He didn't want to join a group that he would have trouble with, so the only logical choice was to join a group that held some of the same values as him, and that he could control if they tried to force something onto him. Lancer wasn't sure what to feel about that. Why get so much power though, since you already conquered Earth using bloodless methods? Lancer questioned. Naruto crossed his arms. I feel like conquering the rest of the sentient races on this world is the next logical choice. Just getting some prep done, and my Santa plan won't work this time. Naruto would have to think up a new plan to take over the other races without spilling the blood of a single child in order to keep his other self's promise to Atalanta. Such a hard promise to keep when plotting global domination. The end.